The night sky above Daytona International Speedway is alive with fireworks. We are barely one-third of the way to one of the classic sports car endurance challenges in all of motorsports. The 43rd annual Rolex 24 at Daytona is underway. And the pyrotechnics are cute, but everybody on the premises knows that the fireworks have only just begun at the Rolex 24. After a brief one-hour hiatus, we welcome you back to Daytona International Speedway, where the action continues. The lights are on, and we are still a long way from halfway at the Rolex 24. Round one of the Grand-Am Rolex Sports Car Series for 2005. You're looking live at Daytona International Speedway. We'll get you caught up on everything that's happened in the last 60 minutes. Right now, here's a look at the top 30, beginning with the pace-setting Pontiac Crawford, currently in the hands of IRL IndyCar star Dario Franchitti. Just behind, one of the Lexus-powered Riley chassis from Chip Ganassi Racing, Englishman Darren Manning is right there. Then Jörg Bergmeister in that brand-new Pontiac Riley from the Racers Group and Krohn Motorsports. Andy Wallace, who was the race leader when we went away, is now in fourth place, followed by Butch Leitzinger. In seventh place, Wayne Taylor, in the number 10 car that has been in or around the lead most of the day. They have made a brake pad change, so that led to a fairly lengthy pit stop. And because so many cars are close together, we also had a lengthy yellow flag during the delay. Right now, they dropped all the way down to seventh place, but still very close to the lead because fully 10 cars are still on the lead lap, and the top six are all basically separated by about 5 seconds. Now we begin to see the GT cars mixed in. And look at the job being done by Team 16. Right there in 24th place in the overall, currently driving that car, 16-year-old Colin Brown, whose father, Jeff, is working in the pits. What a moment it must be for the Brown family, for Jeff to be working while his son is out on this world-renowned racetrack. Now, as I mentioned, Andy Wallace was in the race lead in the number 20 Pontiac Crawford when we left the air during hour 8. And at 7:23 p.m., he had this close moment. Up ahead, Steve Ivankovic in a Pontiac-powered chase gets off the track, back on it, spins, and that is Andy Wallace just squeezing by. And the race leader not the only one to come within a hair's breadth of disaster. Unbelievably, nobody damaged in that incident. I'm Bob Varsha, along with David Hobbs, as we begin three more hours of live coverage of this great endurance race. David, coming in, our story was all about the great driver lineup, but you always have to wonder if all of that talent out there from Nextel Cup and the IRL IndyCar Series and Champ Car and so on was going to add up to a great race. Thus far, I think we'd have to say it has been a great race.
Well, you're 8 hours in, you got the first 10 cars on the same lap. You got 5 seconds covering the first 8 of them after 8 hours racing. I mean, it doesn't really get much better than that. At the top of the show, we were talking about concentration, preparation, patience, and all those other attributes that go to winning a long-distance race. And right at the end, I added, and you got to have a bit of luck as well. I mean, that incident that we just saw there with Andy Wallace and the 18 car, I mean, just with a hair's breadth of luck could have been disastrous for Wallace. As it was, he slipped by, as so did everybody else. But that's the sort of thing that can happen in these long-distance races, and there's a long way to go.
Oh, absolutely. We're just 2 hours into the darkness, and one of the key things about the Daytona 24-hour race is that the race goes on for such a long time during the night, much longer than the sister event, the 24 hours of Le Mans. Now let's go down to the pit lane and find out what's been going on with these guys. The number 10 SunTrust car, here's Calvin Fish.
Well, Bob, you mentioned that Wayne Taylor had got into the car, and during that pit stop, they did change brake pads. This is very early on in this 24-hour event to need pads. But I spoke to Bill Riley, said it was really just a strategy move. We had a long caution period. He said it's touch and go whether you can get to the halfway point on that first set of pads. We definitely need a second set. So he said by doing them now under yellow, now creates a huge window with that second pad change. Anywhere between hour 13 and hour 20 is when they get that second change. That's going to give them a lot more flexibility with their pit stop strategy. He also said they're now been double stinting the tires. He said, we're going to have a lot of tires left tomorrow. Remember, the teams allocated just 30 sets to get through the whole race weekend, not just the race itself, the whole race weekend. And 10 of those sets will be the softer compound. They have not gone to the soft compound yet. They're probably going to use a few sets during the night, try and keep a couple of sets at least if the action gets hot and heavy tomorrow. Looking further along pit lane, I checked in with Crawford and Ganassi. Those teams too are still on the harder compound, the 60 compound from Huja, but by about 10, 11 o'clock tonight when the temperatures really drop, they're probably going to have to go to the softer ones.
Tire management, we expect, will be very much a key to who wins this race. Speaking of the 10 car and its drivers, you heard Wayne Taylor, if you were with us at the beginning of this race, say this is his 24th career 24-hour start. But his teammates are also very experienced at the nuances of the ultimate endurance distance. Emmanuel Collard with 18 24-hour races, Max Angelelli now with 9. A total of 51 24-hour races worth of experience. Right now, there they are on track. Wayne Taylor at the controls. He'll be trying to work his way back up that leaderboard. We'll be back in a moment. Stay with us. Speed Channel's coverage of the Rolex 24 at Daytona is brought to you by Porsche. Porsche, there is no substitute. And by Rolex, a crown for every achievement. Back live at Daytona International Speedway, where the carnival is in full swing. The infield is jam-packed. Fans are enjoying the 43rd edition of the Rolex 24. That, the fireworks, and lots of other amenities at this newly reconfigured Daytona International Speedway infield, really adding to the fan experience here. Here's a look at the GT class standings after 229 laps. And remember, we don't know how many we're going to go in total. Up front, and this is one of the great stories of the race, the all-Australian team and that 00 Porsche have come basically from the back of the grid all the way up to lead the class, and they are running 16th in the overall running order, trailing just 15 of the Daytona prototype cars. There is 7th through 12th. Dave Lacy from Canada had an interesting experience before we went off the air and the sun went down. He actually drove around the infield to get back and get gas put back into that car, but he did. He's currently running 7th in class in a 5-driver lineup, including one Englishman and the rest from Canada. There you see the Team 16 car running 9th place in class. 13th through 18th, you get to see those Ferrari 360 Challenge cars, 3 of them in all in the field. And the BMW M3 shown in 16th. But all is not well in the BMW camp. More on that in a moment. There is the 00. All-Australian team currently leading the class. Craig Baird is behind the keyboard right now. And Chris Neville has more on their story.
Bob, while a lot of the eyes have been on the prototype class, GT has been just as competitive. And the boys at the top of the poll right now, that Aussie Assault team, these guys have had a tough day. It's been a real roller coaster ride to start out. They had to start at the back of the pack because of that rear wing infraction. They made their way to the front before Marcus Ambrose had a little bit of contact on the racetrack, which once again sent them to the back of GT. However, they've been pretty good since. They've made their way back to the front, so this team's really excited about the trip they've made over here. They think they've got a good starting point here, even though we're not even at the halfway point of this race. Couple teams that we thought we'd see running up front, big problems, mainly the PTG team. Both BMWs have been withdrawn in the last hour. Reason there, they've had a problem with their rear wheel studs. They lost 3 wheels during the race so far, and Tom Milner just decided it's too dangerous to keep the cars on the racetrack, so he has pulled them. We won't see those cars the rest of the event. Another car we thought that would be running up front is the Flying Lizard car. That car is well back now because of contact earlier in the race. But GT, still a toss-up. Who's going to control this class?
Always great racing in the GT class. And that is really bad news for the prototype technology group. Tom Milner's squad swept the driver, manufacturer, and team titles last year in GT. But as we talked about earlier, it's a whole new world in GT this year. A lot of the, certainly the BMWs are brand new race cars from the ground up. The Porsches are different than the one we've seen in the past as well. There's a look at the 25th place car in the overall, David Schepp, Porsche. That is the car that limped around earlier in the day. Calvin has more on that car.
Well, Bob, the reason that car was limping around, certainly it was out of gas, but I checked in with the Racers Group team, and that car is run by the Racers Group East, a team that's put together this year by Peter Barron, an ex-racer himself, very familiar on Speed Channel, of course. I spoke to Peter and he said as a heartbreaker, he said what happened was we were running it down to the reserve pump. There's two pumps on these cars, one you're running on all of the time, then a reserve pump, which will give you a couple of gallons and certainly a lap to get back, and it had gone dead. So as soon as David Lacey hit that reserve pump, there was no fuel at all, and he had no option but to pull it off, trying to get it to the infield, where there the teams can actually get out there and help him out.
As a result, they are many laps down to the overall race leader and the GT class leader as well. There's a 75 car. They've had an interesting day, including having to replace the passenger side door in that machine after a collision, one of several collisions we've had, most embarrassingly, under the caution flag.
Well, yeah, and it's missing a large part of its rear fenders, probably not helping its aerodynamics, but you're right. We've seen some amazing crashes here today under the caution. That one involving the three GT cars coming down towards the chicane on the back straight, almost unbelievable.
It's a Porsche GT3 Cup car. There are 25 of them in all in the GT class, currently being driven by young Patrick Long from California, the only American Porsche factory driver. A great example of a young guy who went to Europe as a teenager, raced over there, foregoing much of his high school fun time, you might say. But his goal was to become a racing driver. He was spotted by the Porsche talent spotters. He is now a full Porsche factory driver. We'll be back. Welcome back live to Daytona International Speedway. Bob Marsha, David Hobbs, Chris Neville, and Calvin Fish with you, watching the battle for second place in the race and the Daytona prototype division. It's Darren Manning in the 03 Lexus-powered Riley chassis from Chip Ganassi Racing, the Target machine, and Butch Leisinger chasing him in a Pontiac-powered Crawford Moss snowplow car. Ooh, looks like, oh, Leisinger, former winner of this race, was looking down the inside, but he thought better of it.
Definitely having bad thoughts there, wouldn't he?
Well, discretion was certainly the better part of valor there. It's a very slippery turn six leading to the banking.
Out onto the banking now. You know, Butch Leisinger can probably get a bit of a toe off the Lexus engine car. The Lexus engine cars seem to have just a little bit more top end, because if you've got a good toe like that, it makes a huge difference. Going to go down the inside to the chicane, but there's more traffic in the way.
Oh, perfect use of the pick.
Absolutely.
Quite a slower car.
Darren Manning trapped behind that GT car.
That's the Baldwin Tafel car, the Mesco machine. Okay, that battle is now over. Let's go down to Chris Neville in the pit lane.
Bob, down here with Scott Maxwell on the 49 Crown Royal Multimatic team. During that last caution, you turned the car over to Kurt Busch. You guys had some problem early on relating to contact. You had to replace the CV joint. How's the car now?
It's better than ever. It seems to like the cold air. And we're going strong. We're running pretty close to leader's pace, but we lost 32 minutes under green with that CV, so we just got to play catch up now.
You guys are well back, about 20 laps back right now, with Kurt Busch, Matt Kenseth, Brad Biffle. Do those guys start losing a little bit of enthusiasm here, or are they still out there having fun?
No, I think not only they're having fun, they're doing a great job. And no, we haven't lost any enthusiasm. We're just going to go hard all night and see where we are in the morning. I just want to say hello to my dad back at home. He's supposed to be down here, and he's sick, so hi, Dad.
Well, we got 14 hours to go, and these guys aren't giving up.
No, far from it. And I believe they're having fun. It just looks like fun around this 3.5-mile combined NASCAR tri-oval. Very tricky infield road course.
It's very tricky. I mean, this is one of those circuits where you really do go from the sublime to the core blimey, because obviously NASCAR turn 3 and 4 are extremely quick, and you've got a lot of banking there, so you need stiff springs there. The infield corners are all pretty slow, and you need a lot of grip.
On board with Andrew Davis in the Baldwin Tafel Racing car, the Mesco Building Supply machine. Andrew Davis, the chief instructor at the Panos Driving School at Road Atlanta, my home track. Great guy. I was on the plane sitting next to him on the way down from Atlanta to Daytona Beach. A graduate of the University of Georgia School of Business. Still lives in the Athens, Georgia area.
Gives you an idea there with that Daytona prototype went by him of the difference of speed, velocity of these cars. The Daytona prototypes and the GT cars.
They're running 28th in the overall. On board now with Darren Law, the number 58 Porsche-powered Fab car. The Red Bull machine from Brumos Racing. Yo, somebody off.
Darren Law car still in 10th spot on one lap down from the lead, only just. So they've done very, very well.
60.
Now on board the 20, that's Andy Wallace. He is pitting. Calvin is there.
This is an unscheduled stop. I just spoke to Max Crawford. I said, what's the issue? He said, Andy has had the seatbelt come unclipped. So hopefully this is just a temporary issue that can re-clip that thing without having to change the seatbelt themselves, because that would be a lengthy process trying to get that done. And with the heavy G-loading that these guys pull under braking, that's really going to create some problems for Andy to try and keep control of this car. I spoke to Max. He said, we're now going to the softer tires. He said, these soft tires really seem to work. I said, use your 50 compound. This should give these guys a lot more pace here in these evening hours.
Well, obviously they're not changing the belts. Let's see if the problem is resolved for Andy Wallace.
But of course, if it comes undone, if he should accidentally hit it with his elbow or push the button that releases the belt, there is absolutely no way that he could get that thing done up himself while he's going along. It's hard enough to do it up by yourself anyway.
Still a fairly young man is Andy Wallace, about 42 years of age. For all that he has accomplished in his racing career, including victories in all of the major endurance races of the world. Back out he goes. Nice view out the right side window, but he's not looking. We're going to take a quick break and return with more live from Daytona on Speed. Speed Channel has 13 brand new episodes of American Muscle Car coming your way. Check out dream cars like the Shelby Cobra, Mustang GT, and Chevy Impala. All new American Muscle Car premiering February 24th at 8 Eastern, only on Speed. And we know you're going to be watching that show because we know you love muscle cars, because we know they are the stars of the annual Barrett-Jackson Classic Car Auction here on Speed. And I know that an awful lot of you watched it, because I can't walk 10 feet here at Daytona International Speedway without somebody coming up and saying, hey, is the Barrett-Jackson as much fun as it looked? It is, and more. Thanks for all the great emails about our 24 hours of live coverage with the Barrett-Jackson. Here's a look at our NASCAR 9-9 NASCAR Nextel Cup drivers in the field. Best placed of them at the moment, Casey Mears in second, followed by Jimmy Johnson's number four car in third. Then Jamie McMurray, Tony Stewart's car, had fallen back to the back of the top 10. They are back up to eight. And the Labonte brothers running in ninth place. And the championship car, Kurt Busch, Matt Kenseth, and Greg Biffle, with four NASCAR championships between them, and a little bit further back. Among the champ car cast, Paul Tracy, 2003 series champion, and Christian Fittipaldi, spent many years in the champ cars, currently running in 14th place in the number 54 car from Bell Motorsports, that are the defending winners of this race. Sebastian Bourdais driving with fellow Vanderbilt Cup winner Cristiano Damata, and Bourdais' car owner Paul Newman are currently 44th after a fairly adventurous day thus far. And Roberto Moreno, the 09 car, the Spirit of Daytona team, is currently 49th in the overall. A look at Mark Patterson. He was a financial services businessman from New York, a gentleman driver, if you will. One of many in the field driving the Daytona prototype class in this year's race. Driving a car owned by Darius Gralla, Segua Motorsport. As we watch the 03 car currently running second place in the hands of Darren Manning, let's go to Calvin Fish.
Well, the number four machine is currently running third, and Butch Leitzinger out there, EFR, stands by. Ali, you have to be impressed with how these Nextel Cup guys can come in here with limited mileage, beat on the pace. I mean, Jimmy's done a tremendous job for you. Tony's just been sensational tonight.
Well, I'll tell you, they're all good drivers. And it didn't take long to come up to speed, because Jimmy came for practice. His first session out, he was right at the speed he wanted to go for the race. So I'll tell you what, they're all good drivers, and I think that you can expect that from a good guy.
The field is as deep as it is this year, Elliot. What sort of pace do you need to run, do you feel? Are you guys like 95%, would you call it, right now? Do you have some in hand? Can you find some more speed if you needed to, you know, turn it up a little bit tomorrow?
Well, there is a little bit if we need it tomorrow, but, you know, these 24-hour races, you know, you've got to keep it to the end. So you don't want to use anything up. You want to not take any chances. and be there for the finish and then go for it then. And so I hope we're around at that time to do that.
You've been around this place for a lot of years. You've had a couple of wins here, but this year the field has really star-studded. I mean, we're starting to see the days like 20, 30 years ago when guys are coming from other forms of motorsport all over the world to come here and be at the 24 Hours. Very special indeed.
Well, it is special. And I'm actually stunned with the way that 2 years ago nobody thought this would work, and now it's the best field they've ever had in the history of the race. I think that's amazing what Jim France has done.
All right, mate. Well, good luck the rest of the way.
Thanks a lot.
Elliott Forbes Robinson is a one-man world of motorsports. That guy has raced successfully in just about any kind of car you could mention. They're getting smoke from the back of the number 39.
And he's obviously realized it coming in. That's the Mark Goosen's car, Guy Smith. Last year's been at Le Mans.
Pontiac-powered Riley. The car looks familiar in profile. Sports car fans might remember the Chevrolet-powered Intrepids that raced in IMSA sports car racing better part of a decade ago. That car also designed by Bob Riley. You can see a lot of the family influences in that car.
This is a race for the lead. I mean, you just don't...
The 03.
Frankie there had to give best going into the chicane, lost a lot of time, lifted off, and that's put the four car right behind him now.
These are the top three cars running nose to tail. It was Darren Manning taking over the lead of the target car. He shares with former IRL champion Scott Dixon and Casey Mears from Chip Ganassi's Nextel Cup squad. You're right, the four car of Leitzinger is closing fast on Dario Franchitti. We've got a car off. Calvin has more.
Yeah, we're down here with a 39 machine, and this has that ugly oil smell, and I would say that there's some pretty serious damage done to this 39 car. I mean, they had a really strong run. It hasn't been a smooth weekend for this team, but certainly with Goosens and the likes of Sharp behind the wheel, and certainly Jim Matthews, Guy Smith, they certainly held their end up too, and they certainly had a great shot here. Led by Orbit Racing as a new team in the prototype division, certainly had a lot of success in GT, and now they're looking over the engine bay, see what they can come up with. But their day was probably done, Bob.
We heard off. I thought I meant they were wobbling around on the grass, but I guess they may as well be off right now if that baby is cooked. Guy Smith sharing with Scott Sharp, car owner Jim Matthews, and Mark Goosens, an endurance veteran. It appears their Rolex at Daytona may be run. We'll be back. Welcome back to the Rolex 24 at Daytona, live here on Speed Channel. Bob Marcia, David Hobbs with you. Calvin Fish is down in the pit lane with Chris Neville. We've had six full course cautions thus far, 17 lead changes in all. We're looking at the race leader, Darren Manning. Behind him, Butch Leitzinger has demoted Dario Franchitti to third place. Manning, one of many drivers in this year's field who is making his debut in the Rolex 24 at Daytona. As an IRL IndyCar Series regular, he's used to driving on banked racetracks, but he took one look at Daytona's 31-degree banking, and he was impressed.
Oh, yeah, even just driving it, you know, you're looking straight into the track. I thought Texas was pretty steep, but this is full wall of death kind of stuff, you know. You're going around a banking, you know, so steep, you know, you think you're going to fall off down inside, but no, it's good. These cars are very capable. They've got plenty of downforce and plenty of grip from those Hoosier tires, you know. It's well stuck up that wall. You don't want to stop, because you will roll down.
David, let me ask you. You were here for the very first Daytona Continental in 1962. What did you think when you hit that banking?
Well, I mean, I was absolutely mind-blown by the whole thing, because I'd only ever driven on in England at club races and that sort of thing. I came over here, I'd driven a Lotus Elite. The next thing is I'm driving this Jaguar XKE and rocketing around this banking at some ridiculous speed, and the whole thing, like him, you look like you just feel you're going to fall off to start with, but obviously you get used to it, and it was good fun in the end. The most impressive was like 1971 when we came with the Ferrari, and that was doing about 210 when you went on to turn NASCAR 3, so because there was no bus stop then.
Right, just flat out all the way around.
That was fairly exciting.
Mm-hmm.
And of course those cars had ground clearance, unlike these, you know, which are really stuck to the ground. You use the air that goes underneath these to help pull it down a little bit, and you've got good a lot of downforce. Ferrari had a big wing, but that's all. I mean, we still had a couple of inches of ground there.
Coming around, Schoen is 2.1 seconds ahead of Butch Leitzinger in the Pontiac Crawford. Last time around, we'll check the timing as they flash across start-finish. Dario Franchitti remains third, and we still have eight cars on the lead lap.
Well, that seatbelt stop of Andy Wallace's was disastrous. They're a minute and 12 seconds behind now, and they were like 4 seconds behind out of the lead when they stopped. So that's just, and if the race goes like this, that could cost them the race.
Right now, Butch Leitzinger right there is the fastest car on track, 149 and change last time around. Keep in mind, Scott Pruitt took pole for this race at a 146.9. This race is going down very, very quickly. Right now, let's take a look at a race recap to this point in the Rolex 24. Started on a nice sunny afternoon. Scott Pruitt on the pole. Max Angelelli alongside and further back, about halfway up the back. There was Dario Franchitti picking up two spots before he got to the green flag. So he paid a penalty for that with a drive-through. The race was barely 30 minutes old when Champ Car titleist Sebastian Bourdais entered turn one a little too quickly in Paul Newman's car and spun. Meanwhile, Franchitti was learning the nuances of Daytona International Speedway by watching them go flying over his windscreen at speed. Under the yellow flag brought out by Bourdais' spin, Chris Dyson was abruptly hit up the back by Mike Borkowski. That car was in the pits for a long time. Second hour, problems began for the pole sitter and early race leader. Pruitt's car began smoking intermittently. That was traced to a slow oil leak that the team thought they had fixed in hour number three. Nextel Cup champion Kurt Busch spun the Crown Royal car harmlessly. They got back underway. It was a bit more dramatic when Luis Diaz blew a tire and spun in the tri-oval, didn't hit anything, but lost the bodywork fore and aft. This is what it was like on board.
Boy, that must have been pretty scary. That didn't hit a thing, but something obviously broke or whatever at the back, and it ripped the bodywork off.
It was spectacular to watch. So under that yellow
this
flag.
This is the one I can't believe. The way the speed that 80 car was going, this is under caution.
81 of Megan Wick right there ran right into the back of two other GT Porsches.
One of which was the Lizard car, which is now right out of contention. It was right up there.
Long pit stops all around. Into the fourth hour. Watch Matt Kenseth, last year's Nextel Cup champion. Whoa, headed for the pit lane. I think he might have been blinded by the light. Almost got into the Horizon Motorsports Porsche. He could not complete that lap. Some kind of driveline trouble. He thought he had run out of fuel, but they wound up having to take a very long pit stop to get it fixed. Tony Stewart, in his first stint, couldn't get the car up on the cams the way he wanted to. It turned out it was a problem with the electronic traction control. Tony fixed it and went pounding into the race lead. Hour five, more problems for Diaz. This time the rear body work comes off again, no doubt due to the damage in the earlier incident. Paul Newman, in his first stint, got down into that very tricky West Horseshoe and slithered off the track. Hour seven of the GT class, the class leader, Michael Levitas, his Porsche sideways into the wall. Remarkably, the car was not heavily damaged. He was able to continue. Into hour eight, Andy Wallace coming up behind the 18, the red car of Steve Ivankovic. He gets off the track and on around he goes. Wallace just barely squeezes by. And that was a moment for more than one car.
Absolutely. Look at them all just squeezing by because they can't see him around that corner.
And look at all those gouges in the sod at the track side. We had a lot of rain earlier this week. Still quite damp over there on the grass. Cars have been suffering for it. Lead battle now. Butch Leitzinger, I mentioned, he was creeping up on the race leader, turning 149s. Now they are nose to tail. Darren Manning has rear view mirrors full of Butch Leitzinger. Will he get him here? Oh, he's got traffic ahead. And that high speed left-hand kink.
Yeah, he decided again that he couldn't go around the outside because of that GT car.
Now that's
given Darren Manning another few seconds of breath. Here they are coming to the West Horseshoe.
That's experience speaking right there. Leitzinger's a veteran. He knows Darren Manning is a rookie here at Daytona. He knows he's got those two GT cars that may not be watching their mirrors. You just don't want to chance that. And there he gets him. coming out from behind that GT car. He jumped just as they exited up onto the banking, and Butch Leitzinger takes over the race lead.
I tell you, Butch Leitzinger is one of those drivers who over the years has been vastly underrated. He is very, very good driver.
Another second generation racing star showing his stuff here at Daytona. We'll take a quick break and return with more live from the World Center of Racing. Speed Channel's coverage of the Rolex 24 at Daytona is brought to you by Hoosier, official tire of Grand American Road Racing. And powered by Pontiac and the 400 horsepower GTO. With action, anything is possible. Welcome back. We are about halfway through hour number nine, the 43rd Rolex 24 at Daytona. Speaking of Pontiacs, there are 13 Pontiac-engined cars in the field, including one GTO in the GT class. Right now, that Pontiac-powered car, the number four, Butch Leitzinger, is leading the race. 28 Porsche power plants in the field, including three Daytona prototypes, six Lexus, five BMW, four Ford, three Chevy, three Ferrari, one Mazda, and one Infiniti engine, all represented here at Daytona.
Butch Leitzinger was flashing his lights there going into turn six, and there was nobody in front of him, so I'm wondering if he was signaling to his spotter on the roof.
I'll let him know where he is on the racetrack.
And I'll let him know that maybe he's coming in.
We've got a big, big smoker on the infield, and I'm wondering if it's not the 39 car making his way through the kink. Yeah, it is. We saw him smoking earlier. They brought that car in, and it looks like it's a lot more serious now.
That is serious smoke.
He's pulling off in the West Horseshoe. Guy Smith stayed in the car.
Oh, and it's coming out the Auspuff, so yeah. That is definitely an internal malady.
Before you email us at speedtv.com asking what Auspuff might be, it's the exhaust. And I'm not even sure that's the accurate term. So it appears that the race is run, at least for the moment, for the 39 team. Meanwhile, Darren Manning, we understand, is still on the harder Hoosier Tire Company. What planet am I on?
I don't know.
Maintaining second place right now. A lot of the teams seem to be hoarding that softer 50 compound. And with good reason. It's a long night ahead, and it'll be a cold morning even when the sun does get up. So you want that softer tire.
And I tell you what, if this race goes down like this for the next 15 hours, we're going to have some serious racing towards the end, because any one of about 9 or 10 of these guys could win this race.
Let's go back to the third place car. That's the 02 New Century Mortgage car, currently in the hands of the estimable Stefan Johansson. Every time I see Stefan, I still think of those McLaren Porsches that he raced with Alan Prost as a teammate in Formula One.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Of course, he drove the Ferraris before that.
That's right. And, of course, the Champ cars with Tony Bettenhausen's team. And sports cars. He has won the 24 hours of Le Mans. He has won the 12 hours of Sebring. If he can win this race this weekend, he will complete the trifecta. Become only the eighth driver to... The night sky above Daytona International Speedway is alive with fireworks. As we are barely one-third of the way to one of the classic sports car endurance challenges in all of motorsports. The 43rd annual Rolex 24 at Daytona is underway. And the pyrotechnics are cute, but everybody on the premises knows that the fireworks have only just begun at the Rolex 24. After a brief one-hour hiatus, we welcome you back to Daytona International Speedway, where the action continues. The lights are on, and we are still a long way from halfway at the Rolex 24. Round one of the Grand-Am Rolex Sports Car Series for 2005. You're looking live at Daytona International Speedway. We'll get you caught up on everything that's happened in the last 60 minutes. Right now, here's a look at the top 30, beginning with the pace-setting Pontiac Crawford, currently in the hands of IRL IndyCar star Dario Franchitti. Just behind one of the Lexus-powered Riley chassis from Chip Ganassi Racing, Englishman Darren Manning is right there. Then Jörg Burgmeister in that brand new Pontiac Riley from the Racers Group and Krone Motorsports. Andy Wallace, who was the race leader when we went away, is now in fourth place, followed by Butch Leitzinger. In seventh place, Wayne Taylor in the number 10 car that has been in or around the lead most of the day. They have made a brake pad change, so that led to a fairly lengthy pit stop. And because so many cars are close together, we also had a lengthy yellow flag during the delay. Right now, they dropped all the way down to seventh place, but still very close to the lead because fully 10 cars are still on the lead lap, and the top six are all basically separated by about 5 seconds. The night sky above Daytona International Speedway is alive with fireworks. We are barely one-third of the way to one of the classic sports car endurance challenges in all of motorsports. The 43rd annual Rolex 24 at Daytona is underway. And the pyrotechnics are cute, but everybody on the premises knows that the fireworks have only just begun at the Rolex 24. After a brief one-hour hiatus, we welcome you back to Daytona International Speedway, where the action continues. The lights are on, and we are still a long way from halfway at the Rolex 24. Round one of the Grand Am Rolex Sports Car Series for 2005. You're looking live at Daytona International Speedway. We'll get you caught up on everything that's happened in the last 60 minutes. Right now, here's a look at the top 30, beginning with the pace-setting Pontiac Crawford, currently in the hands of IRL IndyCar star Dario Franchitti. Just behind one of the Lexus-powered Riley chassis from Chip Ganassi Racing, Englishman Darren Manning is right there. Then Jörg Bergmeister in that brand-new Pontiac Riley from the Racers Group and Krone Motorsports. Andy Wallace, who was the race leader when we went away, is now in fourth place, followed by Butch Leitzinger. In seventh place, Wayne Taylor in the number 10 car that has been in or around the lead most of the day. They have made a brake pad change, so that led to a fairly lengthy pit stop. And because so many cars are close together, we also had a lengthy yellow flag during the delay. Right now, they dropped all the way down to seventh place, but still very close to the lead because fully 10 cars are still on the lead lap, and the top six are all basically separated by about 5 seconds. Now we begin to see the GT cars mixed in. And look at the job being done by Team 16. Right there in 24th place in the overall, currently driving that car, 16-year-old Colin Brown, whose father, Jeff, is working in the pits. What a moment it must be for the Brown family, for Jeff to be working while his son is out on this world-renowned racetrack. Now, as I mentioned, Andy Wallace was in the race lead in the number 20 Pontiac Crawford when we left the air during hour 8. And at 7:23 p.m., he had this close moment. Up ahead, Steve Ivankovic in a Pontiac-powered chase gets off the track, back on its fins, and that is Andy Wallace just squeezing by. And the race leader, not the only one to come within a hair's breadth of disaster. Unbelievably, nobody damaged in that incident. I'm Bob Varsha, along with David Hobbs, as we begin three more hours of live coverage of this great endurance race. David, coming in, our story was all about the great driver lineup, but you always have to wonder if all of that talent out there from Nextel Cup and the yard and so on.
It's help there in the cockpit. Very rare that the driver change delays these pit stops, but we'll lose vital seconds here. The EFR hasn't fired up. He stalls it momentarily, and now he's back on the way.
But while he was stationary, so was the 03 car that came in second place and will go out ahead of the four. I believe Darren Manning remained in that car. We'll wait for confirmation of that. We saw Elliott Forbes Robinson getting in. Now 63 years old, one of the drivers, glad to have 80-year-old Paul Newman in the race, making him feel like a kid again. The EFR is a terrific driver. He's known for his delicate touch in the car. They say he's the kind of guy who could save you a pit stop over the course of a race because he can milk that fuel tank for maximum mileage.
And he is still extremely quick. You won't see any drop-off in the times in his car at all.
Just the man to have out there dancing around in these cold temperatures on those harder compound Hoosier tires.
I don't see him wearing glasses much either, which is pretty impressive. The last time I drove at Le Mans, I couldn't read the instruments very well without my glasses.
Let's go down to Calvin and hear from Butch Leitzinger.
Well, Butch brought the four car in the lead and he's just given some debrief with the crew. Butch, the car seems to be running great tonight. How's the balance? You're able to stay on the harder compound, it looks like, whereas Andy is struggling a bit with the 20 car, had to go to the softer one. How is your car?
There's a little bit of variance, I think, from tire to tire, even in the same compound range. The first set I had, I couldn't do much with. The second set was mega, and we could just fly around everybody. I don't know whether to go to soft compounds or necessarily the right thing. If you can just find a match set, it's really fine. But, the car was great. It was really hooked up. I don't know who was driving the 03 car, but they were doing one hell of a job. Their tires were obviously shagged, and he was sideways everywhere, but doing a great job of car control. It was a lot of fun.
I think it was Darren Manning in the car. They talk about the field in general. We have a lot of cars out there this year. Has it been problematic with traffic, Butch, or is everyone behaving themselves?
No, they're not. In fact, there's one car out there that's sponsored by something called Speed Secret. And I wish that they'd give them a hint anyway, because it gets pretty annoying. But, the first stint was pretty good, but I think everyone had their shoes in for that one. And it's pretty hit and miss now. You never know what you're going to come up to.
Well, that's a lot of fun, though.
Yeah, no, have a good time.
Hey, mate, good job.
Echoing Andy Wallace's sentiments there, because Andy said exactly the same thing. He said on Thursday and Friday, which is fine in practice, but I don't know what's happened to them all now the race has started. And there's Butch Leitzinger saying the same thing.
Well, while the 4 car and the 03 were stopped, Andy Wallace in the 20 moved into the race lead, followed by Stefan Johansson. The reason Stefan had lost places was because he was just coming out of his previous pit stop. He's now up to second behind Andy. We'll be back. Welcome back to Daytona. Play the official fantasy games of Speed Channel. Speed Fantasy Cup Auto Racing 2005. Just go to speedtv.com and register for Speed Fantasy Cup Auto Racing 2005 Nextel Cup Challenge. Save $25 more by signing up for the 2005 Fantasy Value Pack. More than $750,000 in cash and prizes, and 9 out of 10 people win. Log on to speedtv.com and check out Speed Fantasy Cup Auto Racing 2005. From just above the old tunnel here at Daytona International Speedway, there's a new one under turn 4. There is Matt Kenseth, last year's Nextel Cup champion. Now that's an elaborate looking helmet.
It's very elaborate looking.
He's radio got cord on the top, drink tube out the front.
He's got everything on it.
And there is the 04 car of Elliott Forbes Robinson. Just after he said all those nice things about how fast Elliott is.
And how steady and how careful, you know what I mean?
Yep, took it off the racetrack. Right now, he's about to fall into the clutches of the number 10 in the hands of Wayne Taylor. Let's take a look at what happened to EFR.
I always said he was no good.
Ooh, wait a minute. That is weird. They were off the race. It looks like they used that bit of track in the foreground, the inner circle, if you will. That is not a part of the racetrack for this event. That is a part of the new motorcycle layout for the Daytona 200 AMA race coming up in March during Bike Week. There you see to the left of your screen, you see the new bit that was added for the bikes in order to keep them off the east banking. The bikes will actually go in the opposite direction from left to right on that part of the track and then shoot off to the backstretch at the right of your screen before using the east banking.
Well, there you see the track map. Obviously, there's no elevation change here at all. We've got 8 corners. Because we don't really count the banking as corners here. Turn 1 is a decreasing radius corner that comes down there. Then turn 3, the International Horseshoe. 4 is a dogleg. 5, and of course that motorcycle track comes just through there. So that it cuts their speed down as they go onto the banking. Then obviously 6 is a very important corner here because you want to get some speed up because there's a long way down to turn 7 and 8, the chicane. And obviously you want to make a really good exit out of the chicane as well, because it's a long way from the chicane back to turn 1.
I should point out, you'll see the Daytona 200 motorcycle race here on speed. And there you see the tire tracks left by Elliott Forbes Robinson and Wayne Taylor. Look at how the front of this car has been sandwiched.
I've never seen him wearing glasses. If he went around the wrong track, perhaps he should start wearing glasses.
defensive
stay out.
This is the 49 NASCAR Champions car. Chris Neville is there.
Kurt Busch just brought this car in. They did fuel, they did tires. Matt Kenseth just got in the car. They're a little bit slow here. I don't know if there's a problem getting Matt into the car or if they're just trying to take their time. You got to remember, these guys are quite a ways back, so they're just kind of forging along right now, putting some more time on the car.
Watch Matt adjusting that. That's the, I believe that's part of his Hans head and neck restraint. It looks like it was right on the skin of his
body
neck.
Bodywork on Tracy's car starting to fly off. Got a flat tire, left rear's gone down, and it's starting to flare around. It's coming undone. The tire's coming unraveled and damaging the rear bodywork, and there's all sorts of other stuff in there, pipes, oil coolers and such.
Great drama here at the 43rd Rolex 24 at Daytona. Glad to have you with us. I'm Bob Barsha with David Hobbs, Chris Neville, Calvin Fish. Top of the hour here in the Eastern U.S. 9 o'clock Eastern time. Paul Tracy in the defending race winner's car. Kodak Easy Share car, Bell Motorsports.
And Jim Bell from Bell Motorsports has always run a very, very tight ship. And they got off to a terrible start today when they had that brake bias problem. And that tire is not doing that bodywork any good at all.
Jim Bell worked as a mechanic for Al Holbert, the late Al Holbert, a many-time winner of this race. Won Le Mans with the Whittington brothers in 79, brought Emerson Fittipaldi out of retirement to drive a sports car race a decade and a half or so ago. In fact, he owns both of Emerson Fittipaldi's Indy-winning champ cars. Right now, as David so aptly pointed out, they are having an absolute nightmare of a Rolex 24. Tracy has reached the pits.
But that, obviously that bodywork's gonna need changing. And you don't know what else has gone on under there either.
Back in the 80s that Emo drove in a sports car race in the streets of Miami before coming out of retirement for good and racing a champ car.
I was in that same race.
Yes, you were. Put on a heck of a show trying to chase down Al Holbert and Derek Bell, too.
The co-driver let us down badly. Young Darren Brashfield. I've never let him forget it either. Hope he's watching today.
I wasn't going to mention it. There is Tracy now. Paul Tracy, I must say, has been quite the model citizen here. He has been very humble in his approach to his first Rolex 24 at Daytona. He said he just wants to get the time in. He's always wanted to run the race. Very deferential toward his co-drivers. There's a quick fix going on. Chris Neville is watching it from up close.
Bob, not much more than just changing that tire and then trying to repair the bodywork. There's a big hole in that rear deck lid, and they're taping that up right now. So it doesn't look like there's anything going on with the suspension there other than maybe just a blowout on this left side. So this team's just having a real hard go at it today, trying to defend their championship, or the win that they had here last year. So strong in 2003, winning the championship. Came back last year, grabbed the win here, and then after that, they really had a tough year, just haven't gotten back on form with what they were doing in 2003.
Well, here's a good example of a team that is thinking ahead. They knew Paul Tracy was coming around with a torn up left rear fender, so they already had prepared that patch using racer's tape. When the car came in, all they had to do, as Chris pointed out, was slap it on, change the tire, send Tracy back on his way.
But that structural, you know, the rigidity's gone out of that fender, so hopefully it'll last for another 6-15 hours.
Pretty amazing that left tail light is still working.
It's incredible, isn't it?
Look where the wires run for that.
Obviously not through that hole.
Not anymore, anyway. So look out the back of the Kodak machine. Paul Tracy brings it back up to speed. Just another little adventure, all part of the Rolex 24. Welcome back to the Rolex 24 at Daytona, live here on Speed Channel. We're watching the battle for sixth in the overall and the Daytona prototype class. Elliott Forbes Robinson and his Pontiac Howard Crawford has Oliver Gavin just behind in that blue Pontiac-powered Riley chassis. Those cars were nose-to-tail working traffic a moment ago. Now EFR has managed to stretch out a few car lengths. Let's see if Gavin closes up on him on the braking. Looks like EFR will get a good launch out of the chicane. and hold the spot for now. Let's go to Brian Till in the pit lane.
Well, Bob, one of the other open wheel stars would be Roberto Moreno. We wanted to catch him before you left. Unfortunately, you're not just going back to take a nap. You guys are done. What put you out?
Well, we had a water pump problem. The guys did a great job in changing it, but I think maybe the problem has developed into something else because we did a couple of laps a little hot, so we don't know. But it's a sad day for the Spirit of Daytona team. It's a great team. Unfortunately, it seems like I need to postpone my endurance race. It's my second attempt, and I haven't driven more than an hour in both attempts. It's very unfortunate, but I like this category. It's growing a lot, and we'll probably be back in four more races with Bob Wood and the Spirit of Daytona team.
I know he certainly enjoyed his time testing here, and as he mentioned, the Spirit of Daytona, they also have another 07 car for he and Bob Wood. They hope to run at least four races this year, guys.
There's another guy who can drive anything, Roberto Moreno. Looks like we've got Terry Labonte standing by. Chris?
That's right, Bob, down here with Terry Labonte. Terry, you guys were running real strong earlier in the day, as high as second place. Starting to hear some rumors out there that the motor's falling off a little bit.
Well, I think what the problem was, it was running a little bit too cool, so they put some tape on it last pit stop. And so I think the engine's fine, just running a little bit cool.
When you won this race back in 84, was the pace this quick?
No. I can't believe how fast that they have continued to keep the pace up. It's, back then, you know, you qualified pretty fast, but you slowed down a lot to try to save your car from 20 wires. But now they run hard the whole time.
Well, hopefully that tape on the front of the 44 will help out with that motor.
All right, thanks very much, Chris. Yeah, back in 1984, Terry Labonte won the GTO class here at the Rolex 24, driving with his then NASCAR Nextel Cup, if you will, car owner, Billy Hagan.
That must have been the year after he won the Winston Cup. Didn't he win the Winston Cup?
The first time, was he 83 Winston Cup?
Something like that. But he made a good point there that he can't believe the way the pace has stayed up. I mean, you've got to think these guys are lapping consistently only a couple of seconds slower than they qualified. I mean, in the old days, the rule of thumb for a 24-hour race was you would set yourself a really conservative pace, maybe 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 seconds a lap slower, and then be there at the end. Modern technology, you know, has allowed these engines to be much more reliable. The brakes are much bigger and much better. All the drive shafts, the gearboxes are so much better now. The metallurgy and everything else going into them has really made them so reliable. You can basically drive the jolly things flat out. Which is why you need to have 2, 3, or 4 really good drivers. You can't afford a weak link in the chain, because if you do, you lose time, you can't make it up.
As you see, Bobby Labonte is currently driving. He and the car owner, Kevin Doran, have agreed to run two more races together, including the Paul Revere 250, run on a Thursday night before the Pepsi 400 NASCAR race here at Daytona International Speedway on July 4th weekend. Also, the 6 hours of Watkins Glen. NASCAR teams go there in August. And by the way, it was announced this weekend that Rolex Watches have signed up for 3 more years of sponsorship of the Grand American Rolex Series. Welcome back live to the 43rd annual Rolex 24 at Daytona. Bob Marsha, David Hobbs up high, Calvin Fish, Chris Neville, excuse me, Brian Till. Chris Neville down low. We're getting lots of emails at speedtv.com, and a lot of them concern this car, the Pontiac GTO, the one and only example in the field. Brake disc glowing at the front end. A lot of viewers want to know, including Art in Georgia. I've got his email in front of me. What place it's in and who are the drivers? Well, currently the car runs 39th in the overall and 17th in the GT class. And this is a tough effort. Horizon Motorsports, owned by Jim Harrell, a brand new car. It's a privateer effort. The team ran 5 races last year. This is the new 05 Pontiac GTO. Got a little bit less horsepower than last year's under the new GT rules. The drivers are Charles Espenlove from Lux, Florida, Chris Zakiris from Heartland, Michigan, Todd Hansen from Atlanta, Georgia, Frank Delvecchio from Trumbull, Connecticut, and Al Villamil from Medford, New Jersey. Chris, what do you know?
Well, these boys had some problems early on, some electrical issues. They've got that stuff resolved, and since then, it's been a pretty trouble-free race, so they've just been doing some laps, obviously down quite a few laps. They did show up for the first race last year here at Daytona for the July race, ran most of the season since. This is a new car, but just to clarify, this is not the GTO program that GM is putting together with Pratt & Miller. Those cars won't be here till later in the year, most likely at Daytona in July, and that will be the full factory effort. We're looking right now that Jan Magnussen will be driving that car with also Paul Edwards.
And we had Frank Del Vecchio in the booth at the beginning of the afternoon, and he was telling us they've taken, what, 70 horsepower away from that engine over the winter with the rule change. I mean, that's a lot of horsepower.
Absolutely. It's a nicely turned out car from Horizon Motorsports. And actually, it's pretty much unmarked. There are a few cars out there that are. The one behind it right there, the 36, the former class leader, not particularly unmarked after a heavy trip into the turn one tire wall.
Don't say it's unmarked. Every time we say that, the next thing is we see the thing stuck in the rail somewhere.
Here's the subject of another email. Mike McClellan in British Columbia, Canada, asking, what is that flashing light on the left? Is it a local yellow? If not, what does it mean? Mike, here's the lowdown. I have no idea. Actually, it appears to be signaling an individual car, I'm guessing, to its next pit stop. It's counting backwards.
It just seems it started off at lap 31, and that's a lot of laps, and it's very bright, and I would have thought very off-putting to the other drivers, quite frankly, on the exit of the corner there.
That is the signaling area where the teams can send a signaler in case their radios break down. That's the only part of the racetrack where the teams can put someone to use the old-fashioned pit boards, in this case, a lighting system, to communicate with the drivers. Chris, I believe you know more about that.
Yeah, Bob, actually one of the teams that's having to use this right now is the 77 Doran with Matteo Bobby behind the wheel. They lost communication a couple hours ago with that car, so they've been using that signaling area and actually talking to Dorsey Schrader earlier in the weekend. You know, pretty much all the drivers who have been here say that signaling area is very difficult to see, but this team right now not having any problems, just not being able to talk with their drivers in the car.
Well, they certainly can't miss that sign, that's for damn sure.
It would be tough to spot a pit board, though, along that wall, especially with that carnival going on behind the grandstand. As you can see from the shelter they've built, they plan to be there all night long. Well, now it's gone up again to lap 20. If one of you can suss it out, we'd be glad to hear what your theory is. There is the number 8 RX.com machine, crewed in part by the young Frizzell brothers. Tommy Erdos is currently behind the wheel. It's a BMW powered Doran chassis. It's a one-of-a-kind car and engine combination. There's the Frizzell boys, as we talked about this afternoon, Bert and brother Brian. Their father Brad Frizzell raced for many years, won the 12 hours of Sebring back in the 70s.
I raced against Brad a lot, and of course he's getting both of these boys of his are in open wheel racing as well as this, so old Brad's really pushing the boat out on the old dough on the kids.
He is that. Actually, my son Matt races with the Frizzell boys and spent some time with Brad Frizzell. It is very much a family effort. Tommy Erdos, as I mentioned, behind the wheel. Mike Newton of England is also driving. He races in the FIA GT Championship in a Saleen S7R with Tommy Erdos, who's Brazilian by birth, living in England now. He was the British GT champion in 2002. Car looking clean as well. To have an unmarked car this far into the Rolex 24 is something. Kind of like a stock car race at Bristol, Tennessee. The knocks just come from somewhere. We'll talk about that pit sign when we come back. Speed Channel's coverage of the Rolex 24 at Daytona is brought to you by Axiom, the global leader in customer information management solutions. Let Axiom help you grow great relationships with your customers. And powered by Pontiac and the 400 horsepower GTO. With action, anything is possible. Campfires are burning on the infield here at Daytona. All part of the show at the Rolex 24. There is the number 20. Pitting. Didn't notice we get a driver change. Andy Wallace still driving or not? Lammers, Jan Lammers has taken over for Andy Wallace. That will drop down the order probably to about 7th or 8th by the time he gets back on track. But remaining on the lead lap, 6 cars currently on the lead lap with the race leader. Car number 2 in the hands of Dario Franchitti. A car that looks very much like this one, I should point out.
So if they go pit stop, drop from 1st to 6th, gradually work your way through the next stint up to 1st, which is what these guys seem to be doing regularly, leading. Then the other guys stop and they lead for a few laps. Then they have their stop, drop back to about 5th or 6th, and by the end... Whoa! Ooh. Oh my goodness me. Now there's a bit of luck.
Well, some guys just like to leave the pits and go on their merry way.
And
some guys like to do it with a bit of a flourish.
And as he kept it going there, he hardly locked up those tires at all. Probably really didn't put a flat spot on those brand new tires, of which are in short supply. There you see that plastic...
A plastic windshield sheathing is about to come off. It's got to be annoying. Maybe a spotter up atop the grandstand asked, "Where are you on the racetrack? I can't see you." He said, "Well, watch this. Let's take another look." Whoopsie.
Yeah, the wheel's locked up a little bit, but I tell you what, not much. He was very good there. He just flicked that thing around.
Maybe he wanted to clear the windshield. In which case, he's doing it. Yep, wrong side, though. Only on the passenger side.
He's going to stretch away through it.
And he is not being caught up for position there. The 3 car is running 17th.
But the point I was making, you know, when they go from 1st to 7th, then they gradually work their way up to 1st again. So this last group of stops is going to come absolutely crucial tomorrow. They're all hoarding those soft tires.
Right. When you try to come in first and go out first.
They've got to work it out so that you're at the top of the heap when the clock ticks by 12:10 tomorrow.
Crowded down there, the run down to the East Horseshoe. Mark Patterson now in the number 3. It's a Lexus-powered Fab car. Patterson, a financier from Connecticut, part-time racer. We'll switch to a BMW-powered Riley for the other 13 races of the season in a joint effort with Southern Motorsports. Darius Gralla, Bowden Prozek, Quentin Wall, and Shane Lewis also on the driving train. Lewis and Gralla will drive the rest of the season. They'll add a driver for the longest races, like the 6 hours of the Glen, of course. Right now, Patterson, an interesting guy. He picked up an interesting ride last fall. He drove in the first Chinese Formula One Grand Prix weekend of a Formula BMW race. Not too many drivers can say that. Let's go down to the pit lane and Brian Till.
Well, guys, here with Andy Wallace, who just got out of the 20 car. You guys have been strong all day long, Andy, putting the car back up to the front every time. You drop back on a pit stop. Did you happen to see Jan spin on the first lap out?
What happened?
Obviously, you guys are on cold tires. You're running on the soft one. It looked like he got to this international horseshoe in the lap out and just did a nice lazy spin. Didn't say anything on the radio?
Well, I wasn't listening on the radio, but yeah, it's very, very slippery out there still. Unfortunately, twice I had the seatbelt pop open. So that's why we had to make the extra stop to put the seatbelt back on. So we're a bit behind on stops for that reason, but otherwise the car's running fine.
Is that an issue with the latch on the belt, or are you somehow bumping it with your elbows while driving? Or
I think what it is over the bumps, the shoulder strap, there's a piece on the end of the shoulder strap which is quite heavy. We think it's banging the buckle and undoing it. So when I was going around, I tried to get one hand and tuck it all in, and it didn't happen again. So maybe that's what it is.
Now, you guys are one of the few teams right now running on the soft compound tires. Is it time to do that, or is that something you guys just decided to try and see if it was going to work? Will you go back to the hards, or are you going to stay on softs all night long?
We wanted to try it to see if it works. It's okay, but I don't know if I'm right in thinking that you have some of each. Everybody does, so you've got to use them all up. And now's as good a time as any to use up the softer ones, I would have thought.
One of those things that the soft ones just seem to come in and last a little bit longer, or just a little softer, a little more grip?
Well, now you've just told me we're the only ones on the soft ones. I'm not telling you anything.
Seems like I might have given a secret away, guys.
That you did. Meanwhile, we've got action up on the track. The two?
Yeah, the two car, nudge that GT car coming onto the...
That's the race leader.
Out of turn six.
Dario Franchitti, he's got a flat right rear.
He's done something to it. Yeah, it looks like it's going down that right-hand corner.
It is now effectively a tricycle. Yeah, right rear is down.
He just clipped that GT car coming up onto the banking.
Now he really has to be careful. The car won't steer or stop the way it did.
Probably chipped the rim. Doesn't seem to have done any damage to the bodywork around the wheel, so obviously didn't hit the bodywork and the wheel. Now he's just going to make sure it gets back without that tire unraveling.
Check the 66 going by. Now he's taking it very gently.
Well, the 66 was 27 seconds behind him. But we'll soon make that up.
To go yet. Coming off the bank in NASCAR turn four. Let's take another look. Got a full head of steam up. Trying to get up on. I think he just slides up the track into that GT portion.
Well, you see, the 43 car just didn't give him any room at all. He was right down cutting the grass as it was with his left wheels.
And in the pits comes Franchitti. Hits his marks. To take advantage of the opportunity for a driver change. Look at the way that rim is bent. Wow. Hard to believe he could do that much damage. Brian Till.
Well, guys, most of the damage is to the wheel itself. I see very little on the bodywork, which tells me he hit pretty squarely on that wheel. Now, there could be damage underneath the car that we've not seen yet, and that's the problem. Even a small crack now, we've got a long ways to go in this race, and with all the loads going through it, it could eventually break. Remember, we watched Tony Stewart almost win this race last year. Almost, just 17 and a half minutes is what he missed by, so any hit could be detrimental. Much later on, guys.
And of course,
well, if I hit that wheel that hard, it could have pushed the drive shaft into the gearbox, all sorts of things could have gone wrong.
And it was the right rear suspension that gave away on Tony. There's Bill Catuno climbing in, the only woman to win a feature event in the Grand American Rolex Sports Car Series, driving with Andy Wallace. Here's another look, different angle. Now, that was a pretty hard lick right there.
Yeah, but it was also a glancing, so it may not have. It just peeled that rim back, may not have hit it too hard straight into the car.
It was Brad Blum in the number 43 Porsche GT3 Cup car. He appears to have continued on his way without damage. Milka Duno from Venezuela brings the number 2 Citgo Pontiac Crawford back on track. I'm going to step away. Lee Diffie will be stepping in. You enjoy the rest of our live coverage. Rolex 24 here on Speed Channel. Remember, we'll be back tomorrow morning at 8 a.m.
This February on Speed, Wind Tunnel returns, so all tunnel heads, you can rejoice because Dave Despain is back. More callers, more email, more hot topics, and more of the biggest names in racing stopping by. Wind Tunnel returns February 20, right here on Speed, and that's at 9 p.m. Eastern. Hello everyone, Lee Diffie and Dorsey Schrader with you. Thanks to Bob and David. And let's get it down to the pitch. Brian Till is standing by.
Lee, down here with Dario Franchitti. Dario, we'll make a sports car driver out of you yet. I know you're used to open wheel stuff, but doing a great job right now.
I'm having a lot of fun, and the Crawford car is, what can I say, it's great, it's quick, and apart from some idiots in traffic, I'm having a lot of fun.
Well, that's what we were going to ask you about. Obviously, what brought you in on that last pit stop was contact. We got a monitor sitting over here. You can watch it. Give us an idea of what happened.
Yeah. Coming over here, he moves out, and then he just keeps coming in. and he just keeps squeezing me. He went wide coming out from the apex, left me room on the inside, and then keeps coming in on me. So unfortunately got a puncture. You see here, he's wide, so I go on the inside, he just keeps coming down and down. So you know, some guys, they should be, I don't know, doing something else apart from driving out there.
Well, at least you're having fun. It'd be nice to come back and do another sports car race when you get a chance.
I'm loving it out there, having such a good time. Yeah.
Well, even guys, when he was upset, he got out of the car, he had a smile on his face.
And his younger brother has done a sterling job. There's his father, George, in the background. George, who doesn't miss a race of Dario's. He follows him around through the whole IndyCar series and has done a wonderful job. It has been an eventful day for the 44 team, for Doran Racing, the Pontiac-powered Doran. Let's have a look at what happened to them several laps ago.
This is a very slippery corner. It's very flat going down into and returning to the banking right here. Just a little too much throttle on. Cold tires, cold racetrack, and that's how easy you can spin right there.
Chris, what do you have for us?
Well, while we were away, both the 44 and the 77 of that Doran factory team did come into pit lane. But Matteo Bobby stayed in the 77, real quick pit stop, just fuel, didn't even do the tires. However, Bobby Labonte did come in. He's going to double stint, so he just came in, fuel and tires. We just also saw Buddy Rice leaving pit lane. He's getting his final second stint here. They came in, fuel, tires, Nick Johnson out, Buddy Rice in.
George, for someone like Bobby Labonte, who had his original stint earlier this afternoon, how much more confidence does that give him now, coming into the night time where it's completely different, conditions are different, but you do have that first solid stint under your belt?
Well, you think, actually it's a false sense of security, if you will, because you think everything's going to be okay, and then when you go out there, the racetrack has changed so drastically, and the grip level is down so significantly that you see these problems. And speaking of problems, a lot of smoke right there. I suspect the 67 might have just turned around as well. It's, you could almost idle into a spin on these hard compound tires when you're on this very cold racing surface.
The 2004 Indy 500 winner, Buddy Rice. It's been quite an eventful day, but he's been involved in a few different incidents. But the Crone Racing TRG, the new combination, they soldier on. The sister car, the 66 of Max Pappas, Ollie Gavin and Jörg Bergmeister, has been the higher placed of the two and still runs very well in fourth place at the moment. But for these guys and co-team partner Tracy Crone, it's been quite a testing day.
I tell you, you put the new tires on the car, you go out, you think everything's fine, you got a cool head on your shoulders, and then you get one of those little spins and think, I can't believe that I spun out going that slow.
Yeah.
But you can, you really can.
After being on the lead lap for the majority of the, you could say, the opening 8-9 hours, there's been some frustration for the 58 Red Bull Brumos team. We hear that they are in pit lane.
Well, Lee, the 58 car is up on Jack's. Lucas Lure sits patiently in the car, but this is going to be a long fix. There's some damage to the back, but the big problem is up front. They've had to replace the radiator. It doesn't look like it's from contact, but obviously a leak somewhere in that old radiator. They had to take it out. That's going to be a long fix. Not only will it take a long time to put a new one back in, the door says, you know, they'll have to then fill it with fluid and make sure there's no water in the system, and that could take even longer.
Right, Brian, and I'll tell you, we've seen a lot of punctures. This is a dirty racetrack, and the only one you can blame is the drivers themselves. Dropping wheels off in that chicane in there, dropping wheels off at apexes, bringing up the sandy, gritty, gravel-like substance, as well as chipping off pieces of asphalt itself, and it makes these punctures in the radiator as well as tires.
I can't believe it. We haven't had too many hours of darkness as yet, and the problems entering the 58 team, and that's exactly what has happened the past 2 years. It's been a brilliant run so far. New race leader, it is the 0-2, the combination of Casey Mears, Stefan Johansson, and Kurt Wagner. It's the new century. Mortgage Ganassi car, and it's running beautifully at the moment, a 15-second lead. Not only a busy day for the teams, the drivers, everyone involved here, but especially our hard-working crew, Don Russell there, just one of the many camera operators here, and we truly thank the guys and girls on our technical team. Hello to you all. And they're with us, of course, bringing you these wonderful live pictures right through until 11 p.m. Eastern tonight. And we're back at 8 in the morning, taking you right through till 12:30 Eastern. Doing a wonderful job. even the robotic ones.
He's happy too, look at that.
A terrific job, as always. Hello, Turtle. Terry Ford doing a wonderful job. The entire team, thanks, guys. Awesome stuff. And
Chuck Mills giving us a wave.
As we pick up the 10 SunTrust team, the combination of Collard, Taylor and Angelelli, they sit in the top five in fourth place at the moment. The lead trio of Jamie McMurray, Stefan Johansson, Kurt Wagner. Johansson is behind the wheel and the 10 SunTrust car is in. Wayne Taylor behind the wheel, the team principal. Such an important race, this one, with the SunTrust. So many VIPs from the bank here. And this one eluded them last year. They won it this year, Brian.
Well, the team goes to work down here. Should be a routine stop. Wayne Taylor steps out of the car very casually over the wall. Emmanuel Collard will get in. They'll go with four new Hoosier tires and full fuel. We'll try to get a look at the sidewall of the tire and see what compound they're running. Can't quite make it out on the sidewall. It's still the 60 compound tire. They're staying on hard, and they'll go out there. The right side of this car shows signs of the battle that they've done on the racetrack so far, guys.
Lots of emails coming in this evening about the red light you can see in the cockpit. Explain that, Dorse.
Really, what they're doing with that red light's behind the driver so he doesn't see it, but it does illuminate the dash without reflecting so heavily into the windscreen from the inside.
Thanks to all of you sending in your emails via www.speedtv.com. Keep them coming in, and we will answer as many of them as we can. As you see, Emmanuel Collard fire it up, and away goes the Pontiac Riley. It's been one of the top five cars all day long, this one. And it's going just the way Wayne Taylor, Max Angelelli, and the entire team want it to. It's a Ganassi 1-2 at the moment, the 0-2 leading the 0-3. A strong running. And look at this, the 66. The new car for Max Pappas, Jörg Burgmeister, and Ollie Gavin. Gavin is chasing down Casey Mears.
Done a great job with his new car and this new team. All putting together, giving a good show of themselves so far today. Long way to go.
We should highlight the simple fact that it's a huge step up too for Kevin Buckler and his organization, as well as numbers running eight cars here today. And the 0-2 is in. Stefan Johansson brings the lead car in and stepping up from GT to Daytona prototype as well. Something different, and for them to be running at the front of this pack is very impressive. Kurt Wagner's had to make a significant change this year, not only teams, but power plants. He's had to adapt, and we've had a change here. Look at this, Ollie Gavin is through. And that is effectively for the lead if they can come around and get by. Nice work. So let's see if Casey Mears can respond.
Take a look at the infield right there. You and I were just there, Lee. We were down the infield. There are so many people here. It's unbelievable. You don't see road racing fans in the grandstand because it's really cold up there. They're all huddled around fires and campfires and having little campers. They're watching us on TV because that's the way it should be.
Excellent atmosphere. We did get a chance to go down there, and it hasn't really waned any, even into the nighttime hours. But this is impressive stuff from Oliver Gavin, the former British F3 champion. He was on his way to a career in Formula One, but like so many, they get steered in a different direction when things don't quite go their way, and has carved a very successful career for himself, the lanky Brit in sports car racing. And this Pontiac-Riley combination, certainly a potent one. It came to the fore last year. That's the first time we got to see that combination in DPs, and we're seeing it a whole lot more in 2005.
Look at the little sparks there as it bottoms out on the turn four banking coming up NASCAR 4. When you're a driver following another car and those sparks and things at night pop out into your windscreen and out in front of you there, you kind of get mesmerized by it. You just get start really enjoying the whole atmosphere of the nighttime drive. Not nearly as scary as you might think.
Immediately ahead, that's one of our new teams in there, the Hypersport team. That is an Infiniti-powered Doran, and it is the only Infiniti in the field. Something new, and I know that Ron Stukenberg and the gang from Nissan are very excited about this program and the future of having the Infiniti product in the Rolex sports car series. So this is a real experimental weekend for the team. It's something new for those guys. They're not used to driving these type of cars, Joe Foster. We had dinner with Joe last night. He is very excited about this weekend. He's right in the middle of Casey Mears and Ollie Gavin, first and second, and they will come away from the Rolex 24 with a whole lot more information, a real steep learning curve, but it's good, and they're very impressed with that Infinity power plant, incidentally, Dawson.
Well, I'll tell you, it's the first year of the Infinity power plant, and a lot of people are going to ask, is it the same as what they ran in the Infinity Pro Series or whatever? No, it is not. That motor was actually too powerful. They want to hit around 500 horsepower. Infinity has had to go on and build a motor specifically to make this package work, and it's really nice to have them on board, quite honestly.
It's good.
Revs it to 7,700 RPM, six-speed gearbox coupled to it.
It's refreshing to have an additional engine supplier in the series, and I think you're going to see more and more of that as time goes on. Such diversity. Time to squeeze in a quick break, folks, as Casey Mears tries to hang with Ollie Gavin. And look, there's Mad Max. We've got Max the Axe, Mad Max, who will come out on top. The big Italian certainly hopes he does. Back live at the Rolex 24 at Daytona. Welcome back. There are a lot of people on the infield enjoying this race.
I told you they were watching.
Piled in here this afternoon. Race leading car is in. Ollie Gavin stepping out. Mad Max in. Brian.
And quite the driver lineup that they have down here, Lee. Max Pappas is going to take over from Ollie Gavin. York Bergmeister certainly did his part early on. They'll take four new Hoosier tires and fuel. Everything is just routine down here. One of the crew members is going to blow some air through the radiator. Dorsey alluded to it earlier, picking up a lot of trash out there, a lot of stones, a lot of pieces of rubber and debris in the radiator. So they want to clear that out as much as they can. Other than that, it's routine, just check up, make sure that he's got his belt on and everything set, and they'll get back out there and try to lead this race once again, guys.
All right, Dorsey, this Crone Racing TRG team, this particular car, the strategy is to go for just three drivers. Some have four, some have five. Explain the difference. Why would you go for three?
Well, really, three drivers is plenty. Back in the years when I drove for Roush, we would do it with two drivers, with a third as a reserve. You can go as many as five if you care to do that. But the three-driver strategy, I mean, everybody plays a different way. Jack Roush liked in the morning when the car was coming into the daylight. The car's tired. He wanted the drivers to be equally tired. And he won a lot of races. I didn't think they were going to clean his windscreen. It was horrible. And at the last minute, somebody jumped over the wall and did that. That's a big problem this time of night with these lights. So overhead lighting is actually worse at night when you've got that glare problem.
Two drivers to do it 24 hours. That back in the days when men were real men.
Yeah, that was it. That's what Jack told us anyway. Who are you that argue?
So there's both of the Crone TRG cars on track at the one time, but the 67 is actually back in 15th place overall. Meanwhile, the 66, a genuine front-running car on the lead lap and in good shape.
I tell you what, there's a lot of old Jack Roush warlord guys here that did that. Several of them in the booth other than me. Well, Calvin was in that deal. Wally Dahlenbeck was in that. Scott Pruitt was in that.
Pappas has come out on cold tires. It's a little bit treacherous, but he's got good speed. However, he is defending his top five spot right now from Emmanuel Collard in the black and yellow SunTrust Pontiac Riley. This will be interesting because Max is still getting up to speed, getting up to temperature. Collard's been out there for five or six laps.
Usually when you get to right here, you get up on the banking on the cold tires, you feel you've got it made because you've just suffered through the infield with no banking. It's really slippery. When you get up on the bank here, it feels so much better. But now you have to watch this, the braking, and back onto the flat through this chicane here.
Well, already we have eclipsed the amount of lead changes of last year's Rolex 24. We've had 24 lead changes thus far, as opposed to 23 in the entire race last year. It's been a frantic pace at the front.
And we're not near halfway yet.
Pappas defending from Collard. Will Collard make a move? Doesn't often show impatience, Emmanuel Collard. He's been around for too long for that. But do sometimes it get the better of you, Dorsey, and you just want to get that pass, execute it, and move on?
You can, but you know, there's a real calm that comes over you on this nighttime driving thing. Once you've gotten to your rhythm of the nighttime driving, you don't really think about attacking as much. You just get into a rhythm and just really get happy with it all. It's not as hot in the car. Everything feels better. The only annoying thing is that all these cars run with extremely powerful headlights, and it's like burning into the back of your head when you've got someone following you that closely.
Pappas was helped there by the traffic, and Pollard was held up by the traffic. One GT Porsche and the Multimatic, but now he's back out there and the chase begins.
I said it earlier, as a driver right now, what you're looking for, other than the obvious, is you're looking for parts of cars, you're looking for someone who might have lost a tire or whatever, and it's laying out there waiting for you to hit it. You got to really, really strain your eyeballs to pick that stuff out.
Top seven cars in this race have all led at one stage or another, and we have racing at almost 10 o'clock East Coast time. It is full on, and this, you get the feeling that this is going to go all the way to the end, and hopefully one man that will be right in the mix is the guy who's just stepped from the 66, Ollie Gavins with Brian.
Well, he stepped from the 66. He had a big smile on his face. First of all, Doug Feehan will be glad to see that you got your hair cut, your other boss. But it didn't seem to zap any of your Samson-like strength to drive the car, bud.
Well, yeah, I had to get my hair cut because Doug was worried I wasn't going to be able to get my helmet on. So I had it cut just a bit before I came here. But today it's been running pretty good. The car has. Everybody at TRG Peroni has been working extremely hard. This is a very new team. You know, maybe the setup of the car is not absolutely spot on. But, you know, we're working away at it as we go through the race. Max is now in the car. He's, as always, doing a great job. It's just that last stint, I had a pretty good battle with the SunTrust car, also with the 44 car and also the 4 car. It's a great race. I mean, it's so many position changes. You're not really ever sure who's where. You just push all the time. And you know, I'm having a lot of fun.
Well, he's definitely having a lot of fun. You can tell when he got out of the car, he had a big smile on his face. And this guy certainly knows how to win endurance races. Look for him at the end.
He's an awesome driver, isn't he? And just to finish something we started earlier, and I don't know if Bob or David addressed it, but speaking of Crone TRG, Mike Johnson is the team manager there, and his wife Cheryl emailed in earlier. She's expecting a baby shortly, and we wish her all the best. And we know that Mike's family's watching in, I think, three different states. So congratulations to those guys. Also, congratulations to our producer from last year on the Rolex Sports Car Series, Joel Grove, and his wife Jill Fredrickson had their first child, a baby girl, Jane. Congratulations, guys. Mad Max has fended off Emmanuel Pollard. It's the four that now leads. It's been a bright day for the Howard Boss team. We'll follow that up when we return.
Tomorrow, there's superstars of racing from across the globe, and they're all here for one thing, to outlast, outperform, and outrun the competition. The Rolex 24 Hours of Daytona. Live coverage continues tomorrow, exclusively on Speed.
Back live at Daytona, we continue on and getting ever so close to the 10-hour mark. And this is where it really starts to begin tough, to get extra tough throughout these nighttime hours as they work their way toward dawn. That gives them an extra boost when the light comes up. I'll tell you an interesting story about Max Pappas, the reigning DP champion. He returned home to Italy recently and was honored at the prestigious Casci d'Oro Awards in Bologna. The Casci d'Oro celebration, which is Italian for golden helmets, has been considered the Oscars of international motorsports since its inception in 1996. The award is presented by the news magazine Autosprint, and it was Max's third Casci d'Oro award. Others who were honored that night included IRL IndyCar champion Tony Kanaan, F1 world champ Michael Schumacher, and Rally's Sebastian Loeb. Well done, Max. Terrific stuff. Now, while it's going well for the 66, not so good for the 44, for the Pontiac Doran. While we're in that last commercial break, it's Spa. At the moment, they are currently, where is the 44? It's in ninth position at the moment. Bobby Labonte behind the wheel. When we spoke to him after his first stint, he wasn't all that pleased, Dawes, was he?
No, he wasn't at all, and I don't think he's going to be happy with this spin either. Good news is he didn't hit anything. No damage to the car, just an embarrassing moment.
Well, let's take a look at what happened to Bobby. It wasn't too major, and fortunately there was plenty of runoff.
There he is down there going around. That's kind of a strange place to break loose. Like I say, it's very slippery this time of night. That's where you apply the throttle. Let's look. right here. See that? See how easy it went around?
Wasn't aggressive.
Wasn't aggressive at all. Just like I say, it's so incredibly slippery. You just sit there and say to yourself, I cannot believe that car just did that to me.
No harm done, though. Bobby Labonte maintains that top 10 position in ninth. His teammates, his brother Terry, Brian Herter, who's done a great job today, and so too the diminutive Dane Jan Magnussen. What a foursome. Fabulous lineup and a long way to go, and they're still well in touch. At the moment, they're only two laps down on the race leaders. And as you know, Dorsey, in this race, that's nothing.
Two laps is nothing at all. I mean, like you say, we're going into the toughest part of the race. This nighttime, it just takes its attrition on everyone. And two laps, you know, one bobble, two laps goes by real quick.
Right behind Bobby Labonte there is the Red Bull Porsche. That's sitting in just in the top five, one, two, three, four. Yeah, it is in fifth place in the GT category. Carl Wendlinger and Johnny Molum, Dieter Questa. In fact, Molum won the GT class last year. They've had a lot of troubles this weekend and were not very happy when I went by their camp this morning. So to be up into the top five, that is pretty good going. If you've just joined us, hello everyone. Lee Dippy along with Dorsey Schrader, Brian Till, Chris Neville, Calvin Fish in pit lane, Bob Barsha and David Hobbs have retired for the night. And we're taking you all the way through until 11 Eastern. So one more hour, live and exclusive coverage of the Rolex 24. And it has been a fascinating race so far. We've got seven cars who have led. The top seven have all shared the lead at one time or another. And we've got a handful of cars on the lead lap after almost 10 hours of racing. That's phenomenal stuff.
It is indeed phenomenal stuff, and far from over with. It's going to be a long hour for this 44 car. Bobby Labonte is extremely loose all over the racetrack. Doing that for an hour without having to spin is taxing, let's say it that way.
This is the regular graphic that we've been throwing up. We have nine NASCAR Nextel Cup stars in this race, and where they are as far as who's the highest in the positions they've gained. Jamie McMurray is sharing the lead car with Stefan Johansson, Kurt Wagner. And he gained three positions from his start spot. Casey Mears is the next best from Jimmy Johnson. Tony Stewart had a tremendous run early on. And that car sits where it started. Here is the Johansson McMurray Wagner car. The third, Ganassi with Felix Sabatis entry. And the one that possibly everyone thought would be the dominating car of the three, the 0-1 of Scott Pruett, Luis Diaz and Ryan Briscoe. Boy, has it had a troublesome day. If you haven't seen any of our coverage so far, Pruett had an oil leak. Luis Diaz had a crash at over 150 miles an hour on the front stretch. They lost two, three rear body cowlings. It has been a very, very taxing day on that team. But they are still in it. The 0-1, the third Ganassi car, sits 22nd overall. And they're 20-odd laps down.
And in defense of Luis Diaz, his problem was a tire explosion, deflating, massive deflation at the fastest part of the straightaway. Blew the car just a bit, didn't hit the wall, but boy, what a moment.
To Stefan Johansson. This is something special, and this is the beginning of something new for Stefan. He is here in the Rolex Sports Car Series for the entire 2005 season, sharing the new Century Mortgage Lexus Riley with Hollywood George himself, Kurt Wagner, and they'll be a strong combination in 05, that's for sure. Speed Channel's coverage of the Rolex 24 at Daytona is brought to you by Axiom, the global leader in customer information management solutions. Let Axiom help you grow great relationships with your customers. By Hoosier, official tire of Grand American Road Racing, and powered by Pontiac, the 400 horsepower GTO. With action, anything is possible. And anything is possible right here, right now, tonight. We're with you for another 55 minutes live here on Speed Channel. The 2005 Rolex 24 at Daytona. Hasn't been too many people on the Ferris wheel today, Dorsey. It's been a little too chilly.
A bit cold up there, I think.
Great performance from this man, though, Stefan Johansson. And I remember talking to him last year at the Indy 500 on pole day, and he said, tell me a little bit about this Rolex series. He said, I quite like the look of it. And he said, I don't know how, but I'm going to be in it next year. Yeah. And true to his word, here he is.
There's a lot of people saying that.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, the biggest problem has been for the car manufacturers to build these cars quickly enough. Last year, we only had 17 cars in the whole world. Now we're looking at, you know, 30-some-odd cars.
Yeah, already 30-plus.
And orders for many more yet. But they can only build them so quickly.
At the moment, Stefan enjoys a 15-second lead over Casey Mears. So he's doing it comfortably. That's over the sister car as well. So it's a Ganassi 1-2 at the moment, followed by Krohn, TRG. He's coming up into some traffic. He's got the second Agilent Consulting TPC Porsche to contend with. And three GT cars up ahead.
Got an email from one of my old fabricators on my Tom Boy Racing Mustang. Rob asked, hey, Dorsey, are carbon chassis allowed? Are only two frames allowed? Well, they're all two frames, Rolf, and thanks for the question. Nice to hear from you.
There's the interval back to second. Casey Mears at 15-second margin. He's doing it comfortable, and Casey's got another 12, 13 seconds back to Max Pappas, so he's doing it comfortably as well. And then we go back to Emmanuel Collard in the SunTrust car from the four of Elliot Forbes. Robertson, problems for the 59, the Brumos Porsche.
Trouble at the back. I think he might have a flat tire. I'm not sure.
Rear left, is it doors?
Possibly. There's something bouncing around at the back for sure. It could be a left rear. We'll know here when he makes this corner. No, that looks all right. I think he just might have got off the track and all that bouncing might have been trying to get it up in the gear. It's J.C. France in the car driving. He's had a bit of an off-road skirmish here. Nothing major, doesn't look like. He's had a hard time getting it going.
This car reached a point earlier in the race. I'm not sure if you mentioned it already, Dorsey, but this car, which is one of the originals in Rolex Sports Car Series, completed 10,000 competition miles.
And just a couple days ago, it was wadded up into a big ball up on its roof.
You know when Timo Bernard tipped it over, though, with that stuck throttle, it looked trashed, and a lot of it was trashed, but there was absolutely no structural damage. The chassis was
complete tack.
It was perfect.
The back bodywork seems to sure be bouncing around behind the rear wheel a little bit. I don't know if that's weakened or something like that.
Brian Till, what do you have?
Well, Lee, you see the 80 Porsche of Team Seattle is in, and Don Kitsch, one of the team members, standing here beside me. He's got a check, $186,031. Now, that's not the money that you're willing to give to me, and that's not the money that you guys have laid out to go racing so far. This is interesting because it's going the other way around. Every time you guys go around, you make money. How does that work?
Well, I'll tell you three things. If you're going to drive a race car for a charity, you come to the Rolex 24 Hours of Daytona, you have speed, coverage, and you drive for Grand Am, the best sanctioning body in sports car racing. Team Seattle has won this thing twice, taking two second places, but we win every year for our children at Children's Hospital of Seattle. It's a big fundraiser for Children's Hospital. Right now we're lapping at $527 a lap, and as of 9:45, $186,031, and every dime of that money goes to our kids at the Miracle House, our wonderful Children's Hospital of Seattle, the most best pediatric healthcare provider in the nation.
That is absolutely fantastic. Of the years that you've done this, the 9 years, how much money have you raised for the kids in the hospital?
$1.5 million, and we couldn't have done it without Speed, Grand Am, and Rolex 24.
And what a great cause. $1.5 million for the hospital and the kids. Lee, that's almost as much as you make in a year.
Yeah. Well, to Don and everyone involved from Team Seattle, they've been doing that for years, and it is such a great cause. Congratulations to you. Coming to Speed later this month, Build or Bust. One novice bike builder has 30 days to create a one-of-a-kind custom bike. If the bike makes the grade, they get to ride it home. Not a bad deal. Don't miss it. The season premiere, Build or Bust, February 23 at 8 Eastern, right here on Speed. And that's what sports car racing's all about. Camping out, having a barbecue, having a fire, a few beers, and watching some of the best drivers in the world tear it up around Daytona. And one of the best domestic drivers, Greg Biffle, is with Calvin.
He is, Lee, and one of three Nextel Cup stars in the 49 Multimatic. Greg, how's it been going? I know you lost a lot of time with that CV joint that had to be replaced, but now the car's back on track. How is it performing for you?
The car is running really good. Multimatic guys have done a great job. The engine's running really good. It's just unfortunate we lost that time. I felt like the end of my stint there, I was running real competitive laps, same laps as the leaders were. So that's really exciting for me. But ready to get back in the car. We've got to get Matt in here and get him out of it.
I know you love road racing. Immediately when you started to do some road racing in the truck, you scored victories. You sat on the front row of the Glen with Jeff Gordon in the Cup car. So you feel really comfortable in turning left and right.
Yeah, I really am. And I'm surprised how well I got picked this up. And following a lot of these faster cars through these corners, I've learned some braking zones and some corner entry. It's a lot different than anything I've ever done, but I really enjoyed it. I think I'm going to run a couple more of these this year, so I'm excited.
All right, mate, great to see you here. Good luck.
Thank you.
That's good news. That's to add to the news that the Labonte's will do a couple more as well. And, of course, Greg is the most recent NASCAR Nextel Cup winner. The end of last season, the Ford 400 at Homestead Miami Speedway. It was a great way to end the year. Nothing like rounding out the season, Dawes, with a win, huh?
Oh, man, nothing like that. It's a good road racing experience. Of course, all these guys drive for Jack Roush. No stranger to this race or to this place, having won it 10 times out of 10.
You just heard Greg say, we got to get Matt out of it, bring him back in. I want my turn.
Yeah, now the guys are enjoying it, Get on the radio and tell your boy, bring it in, would you? You're hawking the show here.
Let's talk some GT for a moment. And while the Farnbacher USA car continues to dominate the GT class over the TPC entry of Mike Levitas, Randy Popes and their gang, the Nonnemakers are in third in that class. And fourth was the 0-0 car. Brian, we understand it's gone behind the wall. I think Brian Till is following up on that story. This is your GT class leader, though. And these guys have had a very strong run today. We didn't really classify them as a strong driver lineup, but it appears as though Wolf Hensler's teammates have done a good job.
Well, they've been carrying the mail. There's no question about Wolf. We knew how fast he would be, but we were uncertain, compared to other teams' driver lineups, how this would fare. Well, they made believers out of us. They're winning.
Hensler's very excited about racing in the USA as well. We saw him last year, not only at the Formula One race with the Porsche Super Cup support events, but he did two Speed World Challenge races in the GT class. Loved that. He was victorious and said, I've done a lot of what there is to do in Europe. I'm really excited. I hope I can race in America.
Yeah, there's some really good racing going on over here. I mean, with the with road racing on a decline some years back, this series has brought it back to life without question. As you can see, we have drivers from every venue of racing from all over the world. It does not get any better than this.
Hensler has a handy lap, handy lead, I should say.
Easy for you to say.
Over the TPC Porsche. So these guys are doing it comfortably at the moment. Fast approaching the 300 lap marker. As we climb on board with the 36, a very strong combination here of Randy Popes, Mike Levitas, John Littlechild, Spencer Pompelli, and the French-Canadian Jean-Francois Dumoulin. What a lineup, five brilliant drivers, and these guys will fight all the way to the end. Let's have a ride for a moment.
The red light that pops on there every once in a while is his rev limit light, or it's giving him a warning that he's getting close to red line, ship point, if you will, where it was. Good graph going here as we move to the outside. Coming on off this bank, we'll reach the flat, and he gets passed by one of the prototypes.
That was the 20.
Of course, he knew it, but we didn't. 20 whistles by, right down in the start-finish line right here. And there goes another one.
That's the 79 Newman car. And you may have noticed the obvious change in livery for these guys for TPC. They did run in the white and green and red colors last year at the Turbo Performance Center. It's Mike Levitas' business. But I've noticed, you'll notice the increased exposure, the Agilon Consulting sponsorship on there, the red and white. They've stepped up from SGS
there.
To GT. It's a close call there, wasn't it?
I think they hit. I think the 79 just rubbed that other GT car out the way.
And that's Cristiano D'Amato that's behind the wheel right now. So a close call for Chris. Climb on board with the Flying Scott, Robin Liddell. This is the man who was running second in class. He was chasing down Wolf Hensler in his opening stint.
Yes, he was. Been doing a very good job around here. Shows you how congested it can be, all these cars running together. And those are DP cars in front of them.
We mentioned, too, some troubles for the 0-0 machine, the Aussie Assault. Marcus Ambrose, Craig Baird, Paul Morris. Brian, what's the deal?
Well, Lee, sorry about that. It was hard to find anybody because they've all run back to the garage to see if they can effect some repairs to this car. The bad news is, it seems that the gearbox is gone in that Porsche. I asked if they were going to change it. They said, what's the point? It'll take an hour to an hour and a half to change it. The door says, you know, that could be the difference of winning this race. I mean, everybody can have problems out here. If it were me, of course, it's not my money that I'm spending, but I'd stick the other gearbox in it and see if I can get back out here and get back in this race.
In this race, it's not over until it's over, and it's a long way from over right now. If you look in the rearview mirror here, you'll see every once in a while lights come up from behind. And I've got an email from John that asked a question. There's a yellow light right there in the rearview mirror. Well, some of them are white and some of them are yellow. He wants to know what they mean. Quite simply this, the yellow ones are GT cars. It lets the drivers know what's coming up. A white one would be a DP car, the quicker car. It also lets the fans know, as they're looking at cars coming straight at them, what the cars are, either DP or GT, the two classes that run them.
The Nemesco Building Supplies Porsche powers on with Robin Liddell behind the wheel. Driver changes coming up, and we'll be back in a moment. Exclusive coverage continues tomorrow from 8 in the morning Eastern, of course 5 Pacific, and we're taking you right through until 12:30 p.m. East Coast time. Right through to the checkered flag, to the last second is run, plus post-race interviews and results. So we look forward to that, bringing you back in the morning. Check this out, an incident here involving the two, Sitco Crawford, Milt Coduno involved in this one.
Turning down into the chicane here. Going to make contact, or just has to lock the brake to avoid hitting that Porsche. Driver error there, no question about it. And that voice, evasive action taken right there by the Target Ganassi car to avoid hitting her. No damage done, but you can't be doing this.
And you have to say, wow, look at this group. Look at this group.
This is the fun. And look at that GT car at the back trying to work into that. That's Wolf Hensler's car.
Fine effort, too. On board with Alexis Riley. I love it when they mix it up like that.
The really remarkable thing is the car at the back. Wolf Hensler's 71. GT car is hounding these prototypes.
Well, he's hassling the Multimatic, which that particular one isn't one of the faster cars, but nonetheless, Hensler is flying. Here comes the four. Elliot Forbes Robinson, Jimmy Johnson, Butch Leitzinger. These guys have had a brilliant run today. And look at the speed difference there.
It's all in the braking, isn't it? I mean, they have such an enormous advantage when it comes to de-accelerating.
EFR. Thoroughly enjoying being back at the Rolex 24.
Shows you, though, the kind of race car driver Wolf Hensler is, to go ahead and just, you know, he doesn't care if that car's in a faster class or whatever. He's still going to go after it.
That is your GT class leading car. Meanwhile, we pick up here the 6 for Michael Shank Racing. That's another new, something new in season 2005, that the Mears Borkowski entry. And, of course, Duncan Dayton, Larry Connor running with them here at this event. Mears motor coach Riley being run by MSR now, and those guys running in the top 10, so they'll be pleased with that. Mike Shank said earlier today, I feel we've got a top 5, top 10 car, and they're maintaining that. Meanwhile, the reigning champion Scott Pruitt not giving up. They've clawed their way back to 19th after being as far back as 44th, so it is not over for these guys yet. And you reckon Pruitt's going to give in? No way.
They've got plenty of speed, there's no question about that. I mean, they basically have had just poor luck. It's something that David Hobbs earlier said, luck cannot be eliminated on this thing. It will either be in your favor or not. It has not been in the 0-1 straight.
Calvin Fish.
Well, what was remarkable when they did do that fix of the rear end, I spoke to Chip Ganassi just a short while ago, he said, we are really confused because when we saw Luis Diaz go back on track, it had masses of smoke coming out of the back of the 01 car. What it had done when that tire let go, it actually got into some oil lines. So there was an oil leak, they kept tightening them. There are three oil lines over on that side of the race car, and that was when they got to the third one, replaced on the third pit stop, they finally fixed that oil leak. So once there was oil pressure in the line, that was when it started to leak out on the racetrack. They lost several laps there, and also, of course, we saw Briscoe have a slight off, or actually got into the guardrail, getting out of pit lane itself. So they're trying to claw their way back. The big picture, of course, is the championship. Scott Pruitt is the defending champion in the Rolex Series. He needs points coming out of round one.
Certainly does. That's how he and Pappas won the championship last year. They were pretty much there every single week. And Scott will want to start his 2005 campaign. We have got a caution. And I think by my count, that's our seventh full course caution of the night, the day. And let's find out what it's for. The GTO, the Pontiac GTO is stopped. That's over on the back part. It's right near the bus stop doors.
I think it is exactly there. They didn't, either of these cars make it through. Now they're sitting there holding them.
It's on the exit of the bus stop.
There might be something in the bus stop that made them go. That's been sitting there, actually. This car's been there for a couple laps, so he might have pulled there, broken down.
Chris Sekeres sitting patiently, wondering what's going on. Let's get it to the pits, Brian.
Well, he's someone sitting not so patiently as Max Pappas in the 66 car. An unscheduled stop, he brought the car in. They had to pull the nose off. The radiator packed full of rubber and little bits and pieces of debris, even though it has a screen on the front. Still packed full. They had to empty all that out. Must have been an overheating problem. They at first had gone to the left rear. They changed only the left rear tire, but then they also got to the left front as they were working on the bodywork. He started the engine. Now he shut it back down. Definitely something they don't want to do here. It's taken up way too much time to Pappas his back.
Well, I think Ryan,
in the top five.
Yeah, I think Ryan was right. I think that was an overheating issue without question. Bring it in to do that.
Let's have a listen to the onboard. This may explain the situation.
Oh, boy, that's not good. That rattling around is rods and things all trying to find a way out of that engine, I'm afraid. Pretty ugly noises coming out of the power plant.
And that's why we're under yellow. The Horizon Motorsports Pontiac GTO needs rescuing, and it's happening right now.
Needs a new bullet, is what it needs.
We will make the most of this yellow, squeezing it in a commercial break. It won't take long to get this car off the track, and we will go back to green flag racing. They're ducking and diving for the pits. Pappas, we just saw Casey Mears has brought his car in, and Sasha Masson set for his next stint. We'll be back at Daytona in just a moment. That campfire looks very inviting on this cool, chilly night here at Daytona Beach. It's very un-Florida-like weather at the moment. There's been plenty of beanies and gloves and jackets this weekend. I'm sure that's not what a lot of the Europeans were expecting. But nonetheless, the racing has been red hot. If you've missed most of it, perhaps you've been out, you've just joined us, welcome to Speed's coverage. Let's bring you up to date with what's going on. In the first hour, Pruitt got the jump, but Dario Franchitti was too impatient. He passed cars before the start finish and was penalized for that. Fellow open wheel driver Sebastian Bourdais had an anxious moment early on, but there was no harm done with this. Just frustration, really. Dario Franchitti had a scary moment. He was lucky not to lose the front end of that car, but it just pushed its way through. Next up, quite a sticky situation here under caution. This was awkward, wasn't it? Mike Borkowski from Michael Shank Racing slamming into the back of Chris Dyson. That frustrated the Essex Racing team, that's for sure. The second hour, and Pruitt was leading. This was the first signs of problems And the first problem, really, of many to come for the 01 CompUSA Ganassi Lexus Riley. Kurt Busch, after climbing on board, spun, then so too did Luis Diaz after a tyre blew. Bang! Sent him sideways, backwards, sideways again, many times. Needed to be rescued, and the team did a great job fixing it. Then another incident under yellow, can you believe it? Massive contact there between three Porsches, one of them a class-leading car, the Flying Lizard Porsche. They had to go back to the pits behind the wall. Quite a bit of damage done, so too there, the May Van Wyck and the Synergy Motorsport Porsche. In the fourth hour, watch Matt Kenseth here, and the car that's caused his most recent yellow, the Horizon Pontiac. Kenseth was blocked, he thought he had enough to go around, and suddenly the entry to pit lane evaporated. They had a driveline issue, and Matt could not make it back to the pit box. We thought it was fuel initially. Speaking of big NASCAR stars, Tony Stewart climbed aboard the Citco machine for his first time. He had traction control issues. They thought it was more, but it was an easy fix. Diaz in the middle of this, with that rear body cowling flying off. He had to return to the pits, and they addressed that problem in the sixth hour. Paul Newman, Hollywood star, had an off-track excursion, but similar to Dario Franchitti, came away unscathed. Mike Limited, the reigning SGS champion, he had a scary moment. Watch this, but he got out of it, no worries. Bang! The Agilent Porsche.
The night sky above Daytona International Speedway is alive with fireworks. We are barely one-third of the way to one of the classic sports car endurance challenges in all of motorsports. The 43rd annual Rolex 24 at Daytona is underway. And the pyrotechnics are cute, but everybody on the premises knows that the fireworks have only just begun at the Rolex 24. After a brief one-hour hiatus, we welcome you back to Daytona International Speedway, where the action continues. The lights are on, and we are still a long way from halfway at the Rolex 24. Round one of the Grand-Am Rolex Sports Car Series for 2005. You're looking live at Daytona International Speedway. We'll get you caught up on everything that's happened in the last 60 minutes. Right now, here's a look at the top 30, beginning with the pace-setting Pontiac Crawford, currently in the hands of IRL IndyCar star Dario Franchitti. Just behind, one of the Lexus-powered Riley chassis from Chip Ganassi Racing, Englishman Darren Manning is right there. Then Jord Bergmeister in that brand-new Pontiac Riley from the Racers Group and Krohn Motorsports. Andy Wallace, who was the race leader when we went away, is now in fourth place, followed by Butch Leitzinger. In seventh place, Wayne Taylor, in the number 10 car that has been in or around the lead most of the day. They have made a brake pad change, so that led to a fairly lengthy pit stop. And because so many cars are close together, we also had a lengthy yellow flag during the delay. Right now, they dropped all the way down to seventh place, but still very close to the lead because fully 10 cars are still on the lead lap, and the top six are all basically separated by about 5 seconds. Now we begin to see the GT cars mixed in, and look at the job being done by Team 16 right there in 24th place in the overall, currently driving that car, 16-year-old Colin Brown, whose father Jeff is working in the pits. What a moment it must be for the Brown family for Jeff to be working while his son is out on this world-renowned racetrack. Now, as I mentioned, Andy Wallace was in the race lead in the number 20 Pontiac Crawford when we left the air during hour eight. And at 7:23 p.m., he had this close moment. Up ahead, Steve Ivankovic in a Pontiac-powered chase gets off the track, back on its fins, and that is Andy Wallace just squeezing by. And the race leader, not the only one to come within a hair's breadth of disaster. Unbelievably, nobody damaged in that incident. I'm Bob Varsha, along with David Hobbs, as we begin three more hours of live coverage of this great endurance race. David, coming in.
Well, another Nextel Cup star here in the action is 2003 champion Matt Kenseth. Matt, you just jumped out of the Multimatic. How's the day going for you?
It's been okay. We broke right away and got ourselves behind, so that wasn't that much fun. And then traction control didn't work after that, so we're fighting that a little bit. But overall, it's been a good experience. Getting a little bit better each time we get out. Wish we were running a little bit faster, but it's been fun so far.
know a major influence in you doing this race is the fact that Jack Rice, your co-owner in the Nextel Cup, had so much success here, and he certainly talked about that and got you and Kurt here this time.
Yeah, that's a lot of it, seeing Mark Martin do it and Jack's, you know, success there. So after I drove for Jack for about a year, after I was sure he liked me, waited a year or two, I told him if he ever did a 24 hours again, I would love to do it if I ever got the opportunity. So he's never put anything together, and this is the first opportunity I've had. So I got to thank Crown Royal and all these guys at Multimatic and Ford for letting us get in the car.
Greg Biffle is saying he's desperately hoping to squeeze in another one or two races this year in the Rolex Series. Any chance we're going to see more action from yourself?
I hope so. I mean, I'm going to beg these guys as much as I can to see if they'll let me drive it again. So I'd love to drive it some more. They're a lot of fun to drive. It's real competitive. So I think it'd be fun to do some more if we can.
All right, mate. We hope to see you.
All right, thanks.
Dorsey, how do you think guys like Matt Kenseth and that handle the multi-class format and the huge difference in closing speeds between the DP and the GT cars?
Well, that's about the only thing that they really aren't used to already is, you know, these closing distances on the two classes. But these cars for them are so much fun to drive compared to a cup car, you know, that is a completely different beast altogether. They're not even comparable in any way, shape, or form. These cars are fun to drive. They really are. And the heat that's inside the cockpit doesn't bother them. They're used to that already. But the pressures of Nextel Cup are just not here. This is fun racing, and the crowd's different. And you can see everybody around who's just having a great time.
Here it is, the 02, currently second place. The New Century Mortgage car, Court Wagner, has just taken over from Stefan Johansson. Let's hear from Stefan now.
Stefan Johansson stepped out of the car, big smile on your face. You guys doing an awesome job. You know, a lot of people at home might remember you in McLaren Formula One cars and Ferraris and open wheel Indy cars back in the kart days. They don't realize what an accomplished sports car driver you are. This kind of brings it back, makes you want to win another one of those endurance races.
You know, sports cars always been my forte for the years. Even before I started in F1, I did a lot of sports car racing with Porsches, with Rhino Just, you know, with the 956s and so on. And then I did a stint with Mercedes in between. So, you know, I love sports car racing.
I know a lot of drivers are superstitious. Notice the green suit, not superstitious about the green, are you?
Dude, I've refused to get in a green car before. Everything used to be green because I had my green leaves on my helmet. And somebody mentioned to me when I came over here that green is bad luck. So I've repainted my bus, my helmet, my letterhead, everything. So, you know, this is the first time in green. Maybe, you know, maybe my luck will change, who knows?
Race car drivers, they're not superstitious.
When he's talking about the leaves on his helmet, that's what he's known as, Little Leaf. And he does actually have, he did change it. They are blue on his helmet as opposed to green. But the green isn't doing too much harm at the moment, as he and Court Wagner and Jamie McMurray have had a terrific run and currently sit second behind the four of Leitzinger and Elliot Forbes, Robinson and Jimmy Johnson.
Hey, Dorsey, you were never superstitious, were you?
Brian, you know, the only car that I didn't ever want to get into was an IROC car here at Daytona. They had every color imaginable, but they had a pink one, and I didn't want the pink one, and we had just a moment right there. In fact, I don't know if he got into the wall or not.
That was one of the Crone TRG cars, almost came into the back. Yeah, look at that.
This is the chicane.
And it was either the sister car or the 1910 Motorsports car that it almost hit. That was close.
Anyway, you draw for the IROC car, and guess what color I drew? Pink. That's where I ended up finishing last.
But you look good in pink, though.
Take a look at the replay of what was happening while we're talking about that. A stack up and braking right here. Look up to the top right there as that car's going to almost make contact. That was very nearly a collision again, getting into the chicane.
And it was the 19.
Better angle here.
10 Motorsport car of Mimmo Gidley, the car up ahead, the 67 Crone TRG car. Yikes!
Just really misread that. That's that closing rate you're talking about. The memo didn't think that he was going to break that hard, obviously.
And according to our driver rotation list, that was Buddy Rice in the 67. That was a very, very close call. Here's the fast German, Ralf Kellners, on board this and amongst now the five-member team at Bell Motorsports, 10th in DP. And if you didn't see the start of the race, it started disastrously for these guys, defending Rolex 24 champions. Terry Borchella, the 2003 DP champion, didn't even come around to complete the start. He pulled into pit road. They had a brake fire problem. So it got off on the wrong foot, but being in 10th place, they're still in touch.
Rob Kellner's another one of the drivers that used to be my teammate, not too long back. Great guy, good driver. Joey, they call him.
Comes past one of three Porsche-powered Fab cars, one of the original Brumos cars. Kellner setting some good lap times, reasonable lap times at the moment. In the Kodak Easy Share Doran. Meanwhile, the 0-1. Scott Pruett, Luis Diaz, Ryan Briscoe refusing to give up. They maintain their 19th position, completing 286 laps and hope to be there at the end. But boy, it's going good. The EFR on top. Coming to Speed later this month, Unique Whips. Step into an East Coast Premier custom car shop and watch as Will Castro and his crew turn cool cars into unique rides for the rich and famous. Catch the season premiere of Unique Whips, February 23 at 9 Eastern, right here on Speed. Welcome back. We're with you for just over another 10 minutes here, live and exclusive from Daytona. We go off the air at 11 p.m. Eastern, but we'll be back with you tomorrow at 8 in the morning. Hope you can join us then. Here is an interesting competitor. We talk about the big names, the open wheeler boys, the NASCAR guys. What about this guy racing in the Porsche for Krohn TRG? Mark Slusny. He's not only a race car driver, but he is a real extreme athlete, an extreme freak, if you like. Listen to some of the things he's achieved and he has on his resume. He holds the world record in bungee jumping from a hot air balloon. He swam the English Channel solo, and he was a member of the Himalayan expedition that climbed Annapurna without oxygen.
So he's just not right.
Base jumping is still a bit of an unknown sport. You have one parachute. You have 10, maybe if you're lucky, 12, 13 seconds time to stabilize. If something goes wrong, you haven't got a second chance. So you got to be very aware of what's going to happen. You got to be very concentrated. You got to go and approach it very professionally. Skydiving, it's 60 seconds, two parachutes. You have a Cypress, you have a way that it opens automatically if you're too late. You have safeties that in base jumping, which is still brand new, you don't have. So this sport is not yet for everyone. Unbelievable jump. Unbelievable jump. That's what we call adrenaline kick.
Reminded me a lot of what you get up to in the Keys with you and your mad mates.
We're not that far gone. No way.
What a guy, huh?
Amazing.
What a guy. This, I don't imagine this would be much of an adrenaline rush compared to that.
I've done a bungee jump off a cliff, but that only one time, and that's enough.
Anyway, the 63 car soldiers on in the GT class. Currently, they sit 32nd overall.
At the back right rear, if you look at that fender behind there, something come loose, flopping around.
Race leader, Elliot Forbes Robinson. It was very special, actually, to spend some time with EFR yesterday. Such a laid-back guy anyway. But he almost had this amazing calm about him and said, look, we're not going to do anything special tomorrow. We've told Jimmy what lap times we want to run. Now that Butch and I can do them. If we get into a groove, don't do anything special, stay out of trouble. He said, I think we have a really good chance.
He is a great guy to have as a teammate. He was my teammate for quite a while in Dyson Racing. And There's nobody with more experience than EFR has, and you're right. He's cool as a cucumber. He doesn't make mistakes. He brings your car back. It was as fresh as when it rocked out of the transfer.
The 2004 season possibly didn't get off to the best start for those guys, and it was a long time coming before they achieved their first, their one and only DP victory. That was at Birmingham, Alabama. It brought much relief and excitement for the team and gave them a little extra spring in their step. They lead to the tune of 7.5 seconds over Court Wagner. Emmanuel Collard for SunTrust Racing sits third. And I just wonder who will win this race as far as the power plant, Dorsey. In the first year, it was Ford with the Multimatic, but that was early days before any of the other new constructors and engine manufacturers came on board. It was nowhere near the level of competition that it is now. Pontiac won last year with Bell Motorsports, and you have to say Pontiac has been the dominant power plant here today so far.
But I tell you what we saw last year in the racing was that any of these power plants is definitely capable of winning a race. Now, a 24-hour race, who knows? I mean, we've got an Infiniti that's brand new.
Yeah.
You can't count any of these out. Like you say, we've had more leaders in this race right now than we're just at halfway, not even at halfway, than we had the entire race last year, and this is by far not over.
As far as percentage of the time in front or at the front, this has been the best Lexus, the 02, the Stefan Johansson, Jamie McMurray, Court Wagner car, the new Century Mortgage Daytona prototype. Great to see a new sponsor in the Rolex Sports Car Series, and I know that New Century are very excited to be associated with Chip Ganassi Racing.
Isn't it neat to see all the things glowing, the rotors glowing, the exhaust headers glowing, the exhaust system all from behind? Each of these drivers, as he drives and you look at the back of another car, you're looking right through all that. It's really, really mesmerizing.
That illustrated the distance, the margin, second to third. Collard has some ground to make up on Court Wagner, but they're into a good rhythm as well. And so too the 20 of Andy Wallace, Tony Stewart, and Jan Lammers. They maintain their fourth ahead of Max Pappas in the lead, prone TRG, Pontiac-powered Riley. That's how the top five sit. Then it's the Dixon Manning, Casey Mears, 03 Target Ganassi car. There it is, right there, in behind, and pressing hard. However, they are a lap down. There's Tony Stewart communicating with Jimmy Johnson. Jimmy is obviously set to go, so EFR is coming in any moment. And Jimmy's first stint earlier today was perfect. No mistake, good run, good lap times. I just heard Tony there saying, I'm guessing, so.
He's got the crash test dummy helmet on. I don't know if that's right.
And one of the TRG cars is in trouble, the 64 machine.
Got it around the back side of the wall. The long road back to the pits. Safely. Or he could be going fishing.
Well, MRI behind the wheel.
That is a new road now that you can take to get back into the back part of the garage area versus try to make it on the racetrack.
And that is the long way home, that's for sure. In excess of 312 laps complete so far. Last year, 526 for the entire race, and that was the lowest number of laps ever in the Rolex 24 at Daytona, and you may remember why. It rained for 18 hours of the 24 last year, and we had a period where the race was stopped. But these guys are stopping for no one. Howard Boss Motorsports, the Boss Snowplow car, is leading and leading well, and Jimmy Johnson, Nextel Cup star, about to climb aboard. Speed Channel's coverage of the Rolex 24 at Daytona is brought to you by Porsche. Porsche, there is no substitute. And by Rolex, a crown for every achievement. And yes, it is taking its toll. We're all feeling a little bit tired and weary, but we will be back. First thing in the morning, 8 a.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, for those of you who just can't get enough of the Rolex 24 at Daytona. And we take you right through to the checkered flag and beyond with post-race results and interviews, talking to all of our lucky winners who will grab a Rolex Daytona watch. A very worthy prize. What's your summary so far, Dorsey? How do you see this shaking out? What's impressed you? What's puzzled you?
Well, I'll tell you, the competition level is quite impressive that so many of these cars are still at the same lap, and that, in fact, just seconds apart. This far into the race is very impressive. We saw a lot more skirmishes early on in the daylight, if you will, than what we have seen now. Looks like everybody was going to have problems had them early. Right now, running pretty smoothly.
Some of the people, just when we had a break before talking to some folks down in the paddock, made the comment that they can't remember seeing racing this close with four and five cars on the lead lap at 11 at night. They've never seen this close before.
Yeah, well, that's a fact. I mean, mostly by this time of night, you've got everybody separated by a lap or two laps or so forth. To have so many of them running within just like these two cars right on top of one another is just amazing.
Let's get it down to the boys in the pits. Cal, you first.
Well, I think what's impressed me, Lee, is the fact we've got some real superstars in the world of motorsports out here tonight. Guys have really climbed the pinnacle. They're multi-millionaires, some of these guys, and they're here in the middle of the night. They're just having a ball, having a lot of fun. That just shows what true racers they are, Brian Till.
That's right, Calvin. You know, the other thing that's impressed me is the DP class, the competition that we've had there. More than a handful of leaders in that class, but we're going into the nighttime, and fatigue's going to start to set in. It's not going to be those stars and the cars that win the race, in my opinion. It's going to be the teams and the ones that can stick it out and not make the mistakes on these pit stops and pick up that extra second or two. And that's what's going to get that car into victory lane.
It has been a fabulous day thus far, and still so much more to go at just 1 hour prior to the halfway mark. So we've seen so much so far. And again, reminding you, we will be back at 8 in the morning, East Coast time. We hope you can join us because we won't leave you tomorrow. We're going all the way through to the checkered flag and beyond. And when we wake up, we hope we've got a great race on our hands, because that's what it's been so far. So much more to come from Florida, from the 2005, the 43rd running of the Rolex 24 at Daytona. On behalf of the entire Speed Channel team, I'm Lee Diffie. We will see you in the morning. Don't forget, you can follow the progress on grandamerican.com and speedtv.com. We'll see you in the morning.